On behalf of the AA and HTS, welcome everyone to a glorious afternoon of delving deep into something everyone on screen feels passionately about, writing and its relationship to architecture. Many thanks to Sylvie for helping organize the day, and Sylvie will be with us for the duration, helping us navigate our way through. We have a lot in store, 12 amazing papers to be presented, and I'll get into the mechanics of that timeline in just a second. I did want to remark that what distinguishes the afternoon session and diploma is the Dennis Sharp Prize, which the panel will have to take a decision on at the conclusion of this afternoon. Dennis Sharp, for those who may have forgotten, was an architect, professor, curator, historian, and author. He trained at the AA in the late 50s and went on to a rather starry career, doing all sorts of things across many institutions, but also writing and publishing and being quite devoted to this fine practice that we're celebrating today. The Sharp Prize is awarded annually to one or two students typically, and there are recommendations or commendations, I should say, also typically awarded. That's at the end. I think what we have in front of us is a filled afternoon with some amazing critics who've given their time and energy to being here today. So I'd like to recognize them just to introduce them briefly. Ryan Dillon joins us. Kathy Batista, maybe wave or say hello so they see you on the screen.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Yeah. Ryan, Kathy, Ed Bottoms is joining us today.
Hi.
Mark Campbell.
Hello.
Good to see you, Mark.
Glad to be here.
Teresa Stepani. Manolis Stravakakis.
Hello.
And Susan Chai joining.
Hello, everyone.
As I say, Tim Iverson will be along, and it's a pleasure to also welcome Joaquin Moreno to the afternoon's proceedings. Yeah. Thank you all, and I hope I haven't left anyone out. You know these cast of characters from your lives across the school, and that's what's brilliant about this. There's people you might have met in HTS seminars and electives in the archive, in the library, I would say at the bar, but this year that's a painful reminder. But it's a pleasure that we're all here together online at least. Today's schedule will run something like this. We'll be looking at presentations in blocks. Four students will present one after the other, and then the panel will have a discussion around those four papers. And then there'll be a brief comfort break before we see the next four. We'll have three heats, if you will, to get through our 12 presentations today. At the end, I'll take the panel into deliberations around the prize and commendations, and we'll celebrate. But I want to say at the outset to every student who has submitted papers and been shortlisted, congratulations already to you, and thank you for contributing to this day. And the work, as I've been reviewing it over the long weekend, it's really exceptional. I'm not sure if that's because it's an online year or we're just getting better at this, but there's something quite intense about the writing undertaken in the past year. So without further ado, Sylvie, are there any mechanical elements we should draw people's attention to before we crack on?
So just a quick thing. If a student has pre-recorded a presentation, if you can put the chat, if you can put the link of it to the chat, and then everyone will be asked to watch it in their browser and come back. Of course, be muted when you do that. Mark, if you just tell me the first group, I'll make them co-host so that they can present. I'll do that quietly.
We're going to take them in the order.
Okay.
They're presented online just to keep everything clean and easy.
Wonderful. Okay, so that's, we'll start with Maite, moving on to Neafitos, and then Esther. So I'll make the three of you
four
co-hosts now.
We want to do four at a
four, sorry. And then Brian Ho.
Yeah. I will keep time throughout today because early in the proceedings, it'll seem a little irritating, but by the end of the day, you'll appreciate that I've tried to give everyone equal space to hear comments back from the panel. And every presentation from the students is meant to be at the 5-minute mark. So as best I can, I'll keep us moving along. So over to Maite Garcia La Serene, welcome, and we're looking forward to your presentation.
Let me know when you can see. Good?
Okay. Yeah.
All right, well, hello. I'd like to start by introducing the site that is a starting point for both James Turrell's work and Shortlisted Huberman's fable of a walking man. In the painted desert of northern Arizona, there appears to be nothing but vast expanses of color. The first and main character in this fable is the desert itself, a gigantic monochrome, an endless stretch of color with no visible limit for the walking man, our secondary character. Despite its harshness, the desert is a place that excites the imagination, inspiring a reckless desire to walk across the sands and amongst its dunes while gazing on an infinite horizon. The desert dweller is isolated but not lost. He finds himself in the absolute experience of isolation and of the void. Nothingness, or rather no object, only light and perception, are at the center of Turrell's fascination. The fable continues by bringing us into an art gallery, the space chosen by Turrell to bring these experiences into an artificial frame, translating them into an architectural language. A color chamber is a white painted room emptied of everything except an intense saturation of a single color, a field where light is so intense, heavy, homogeneous, and seemingly without a source, that all hints of spatiality in the room, such as shadows indicating a corner, are erased. Light no longer serves to render objects visible, but rather becomes the object in itself. Through the isolation of color, a recreation of nothingness is achieved. We might not need a desert to experience the absence of a constraint or a barrier. Now I'd like to bring Huberman's Walking Man into a space larger than the art gallery, but smaller than the desert, the public square. A space which, despite its location in the heart of the city, maintains similar optical moments of vastness and of pure exteriority, where the temporary absence of the building's shadows, traffic, and usual visual noise leaves a visitor a feeling of being exposed. While still a design space, the publicness of the square allows for unrehearsed situations in its immenseness. In this sense, it stands somewhere in between the wild nothingness of the desert and the highly controlled experience of abstraction in the gallery. When entering, senses of touch, smell, and taste become overwhelmed by sight in an intimidating manner. In the space that often carries the symbolism of being the very center of the city, there's an all-aesthetic experience that mirrors the walking man's encounter of abstraction in the desert. In the public square, a node and point of reference in the very heart of the city, it is possible to find, ironically, a moment of nothingness. To quote Huberman, a deserted space is not a simple place where there would be nothing at all. In order to provide visual evidence of absence, there must be a minimum of architecture, that is to say, an art of breaks, partitions, and edges. But the square is not limitless in the sense of the desert or Turrell's color chambers. The bounding facades or volumes give a defined edge. We perceive a limit on space. Yet the sensation of immenseness and monumentality persists, even in the case of a gathering or occupation, who rather than giving the impression that the void has been filled, reaffirm its vastness. This sensation is manifested in a limited space precisely because it offers a condition of exception in the city. To arrive at a square, we must first travel through a thick, often incomprehensibly rich urban fabric of the city before we arrive and its emptiness can be perceived with awe. We leave behind a space of opacity. In the city, we are visible to others only in moments and in fragments, with plenty of opportunities to be invisible. But when we enter a square, we cross a threshold of visibility. We enter a space of transparency, where the walking man becomes immediately visible, as well as a privileged observer of others. The square is a large, horizontal expanse, a territory belonging to everyone. When entering a square, we become suspended and abstracted, as if on a stage. As a place for public discourse, the square is a creative space for the city. It is also a space for rebellion. It is hardly surprising that in the event of a crisis, it often becomes a first place to be occupied in protest. After all, it offers a platform for contact amongst others, as well as the opportunity for a symbolic dialogue between protesters and the city. The value of the experience of vastness, be it of a desert, a gallery, or a square, lies in the many ways one can fill it or occupy it to render it remarkable. Thoreau's investigations into the mechanics of perception are a reminder that the world looks and feels very different, even enhanced, under conditions of sensory deprivation. And perhaps this is exactly why they also become places for creation. The square is a necessary void in the city that becomes a place for reunion, a reference for the rest of the city as a note for change and protest. Its emptiness is what gives it flexibility, and that which frames it gives it character. Like a desert, a square offers an empty space with the potential to become a stage. It is a profoundly creative condition. Nothingness, then, though in many ways a solitary experience, feeds the collective imagination, and vastness is a necessary blank canvas that belongs to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Mehdi. I should remind that your paper was created as part of Doreen Bernas' course, Dracula Software. It's nice to recognize where these things flow from across the revision. Next up, Neofiti's Christou, a paper born out of a new course from Biennale to Bed, taught by Kathy Batista.
Hello, thank you. Should I start sharing?
Yes, thank you.
There should be sound, so if there is none, please let me know. With this unorthodox and rather enigmatic introduction, dialogues between film, sound, culture, and space through the infinite mix has somehow formed a dialogue between these four works that has stretched throughout this interweaving of works. They pushed and stretched each other's meaning and boundaries, hybridizing each other, remixing notions of our history and the fiction, the real and the stage, the sublime and the everyday. In doing so, they became tools that elaborate an artificial culture of time displayed spatially, confronting contemporary anxieties, cultural histories, and the convoluted nature of art spaces. Reminiscing Warhol's Exploding Plastic Inevitable, the debutante of Chess Events, Marcel Bruder's studio appearing as a museum and Cedric Price's city as a fan palace, aspirations, we see the infinite mix operating as this testing ground for this chance event, spontaneity for debate, and alluding to a possible future where galleries and museums become dissolved in the city fabric, but also quite possibly begins to suggest another transgressive moment in the art institution's history, a long history of attempted breaks that have only been met with a subsequent surge of the institution's orbit, engulfing anything that attempts to exist beyond its scope. In our post-Y2K era, however, the lines between modes and purpose of production have become more complex. In an attempt towards documentary political activism, Rachel Rose's work, Everything and More, looks at a neutral buoyancy lab, an interview with an astronaut, and an EDM concert by attempting to find the through line between them, uncovers the shared condition of flatness, this deconditioned state. Pulsating life, however.
You're probably not aware, but we're looking at your slides. They're not progressing. You have to have slide view, and we don't want to miss the syncopation of your words with the images you intend.
Are they not changing?
We're still at the first slide. So if you go
in, oh my God.
If you do presenter or present, we'll, yeah.
Oh, sorry about this.
Okay. It's okay. Can we get some help, IT or other, to recommend? We're going to share screen again, and all we have to do is go into your slides and push present rather than stay in the slide file. Yeah.
Sorry, it got cut off for a minute there.
Maybe if you push that far left from beginning, and then you can advance your slides full screen, yeah? Yeah. And then just find where you were in your text and you could bring us to where we need to be. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry about this. So yeah, the long history of attempted breaks with a subsequent surge of institutional rigor to engulf all movements again to this beyond scope. However, in a post-YTK era, the lines between modes and purpose of production have become more complex. In an attempt towards documentary political activism, which rules everything more, looks at a neutral buoyancy lab, an interview with an astronaut, an EDM concert, and attempts to find the through line between them, uncovering this flatlining, this deconditioned state. Pulsating with life, however, at the same time, this almost sculptural quality of the visual composition manages to collapse and magnify micro and macro at the same time, shifting scales and their superimposition to the galactic, the universal, and the human, becoming interchangeable components, overlapping times and places. No fixed beginning or ending, but fluid experiences, implicitly addressing our own mortality, while we become tiny sensors, registering these juxtapositions and reinterpreting our outlook to the world. This is a nice bit here. You can hear the astronaut sharing his experience with gravity, but yeah. The blurring between boundaries, the constant shifting of scales, shatters the distinction between space and works. No imposed frames, but rather a transformation of space through the work. And at a larger scale, all the works and spaces into a composition. Architecture dissolved into a series of rooms, transitory spaces, a series of materialities. And with the city momentarily creeping in, the shifting of perspectives and perceptions never stops. From the middle floor, down the decaying staircase and into the car park, uncertainty, dislocation. With all senses apprehended, the spectators are in suspended, very cognitive state, as if the last room almost necessarily dislocated and detached, with the spectators ready after their training through the maze, take on a more active role, become ready to engage in dialogue. The voyeurs proceed to the final space, become subversive consumers of art. And through this multi-layered tapestry of Cyprien Gaillard, a visual tour de force of man-made objects, buildings, and trees amalgamates to a complex history of racism, revolution, and resistance spanning from the US to Germany. These entropic landscapes from Bombardin, sculpture of Le Penseur, by the weather underground in support of Black Power and demonstration against the Vietnam War, juxtaposed with a rose swaying of windblown Hollywood junipers, or juniper chinesis, an Asian foreign element. Unravel more and more threads of human chaos with LA 92 documenting the biggest civil rights in American history. Vacillating volume and reverb of the film's dub soundtrack conjures a shifting sonic space that mirrors the ghostly materiality of the 3D visuals. Our notions of the stage and the real mixed as we delve into the capacity of the medium to engage spectators in politics and poetics of film and music. Breaking away from all linearity, the more experiential musical structures are put forth, presenting us with a potential internalization of the infinite mix, and the initiation of a greater discourse around politics of music and the DJ as a cultural agent. Beyond these concerns, Gaillard's work manages to bring the multiplicity of topics touched upon in the infinite mix together, as cultural histories are confronted by the entropic character of its framed landscapes, mirrored at the same time in the decaying space of display, where the city's interior is felt closer, perceptually reprojecting its topics back into the world, and suggesting a new dialogue between setting, sense of place, themes, and theoretical preconditions of the work. The adjacency of the infinite mix to life beyond its walls feels more palpable than ever, where the continuous mixing of cultural identities, histories, music, and social phenomena manifests in the most destabilizing of relationships. And yeah. Apologies for the hiccup in the beginning.
No, happens to us all. Thank you so much, Navitas. Wanted to introduce Esther Brizard and her paper, The Home as a Machine, this coming out of Ed Bottom's course, Form Follows Malfunction. Over to you, Esther.
Hi. I just need to be able to share my screen.
Yeah, go ahead.
I've just done that now, Esther. It should be okay.
Can you see full screen?
Yes.
Okay. So today I'll present to you my essay. I just need to make this small, sorry. The Home as a Machine, where I used women's advice literature of the 19th and 20th centuries as a non-conventional genealogy of modern domestic architecture. Functionalism in domestic architecture can be thought of as a response to an analysis of the human body, although often understood through the eyes of notorious male architects. I investigated an undercurrent where domestic functionalism originated from a different set of ideological concerns, the experience of the housewife. The process of housewifeization is a term developed by Maria Meath. It described the shift in capitalist societies when men were gradually forced into wage labor and women became laborers of love and care in an invisible economy, the home. As housewifeization took place, and paradoxically enough, as work was ejected from the home, women's domestic labor dramatically increased. Ever since, women have attempted to relieve themselves from this. Although some feminist activists were proposing to rid the home of household chores entirely, with common kitchens and shared childcare from the 1880s, others attempted to relieve themselves by becoming better housewives. It is this ambiguity that I addressed in my essay, where women were abstracting the home in the most rational and unsentimental of ways, all while fully adhering to the romantic ideology of separate spheres. For the presentation, I'll briefly run through a few of the protagonists in the essay. The study begins in the mid-1800s with the rise of the sanitary movement, which pushed Harriet Plunkett to publish in 1885, Women, Plumbers, and Doctors, in which she thought it necessary for women to understand the basics of plumbing and sanitation to protect the family home from disease. Or Helen Dodd, who proposed designs for a healthful farmhouse. In her book, she problematizes the home. Every chapter ended with a series of questions a housewife should ask herself. All that was not useful was to be removed. The home, the kitchen, became a workshop. The steps taken by women after the sanitary movement were formalized by the home economics movement, created by Catherine Beecher, who believed that domestic labor was not innate, but something to be learnt and taught. Her treatise became the curricula of the first home economics department in America. The movement was carried forward by Christian Federick, who in 1913 published The New Housekeeping, Efficiency Studies in Home Management. Frederick opens her book by saying, "I'm going to find out how these efficiency experts conduct investigations and all about it, and then apply it to my factory, my business, my home." She criticized the height of work surfaces and position of lighting that she deemed had been placed as a joke by architects and builders. She created a visual language to compare the efficiency of her design with previous layouts. Her work was an immense success, transporting the norms set out by middle-class housewives like herself all over the world. She was a great influence, for example, to Greta Schutlehowski for the design of the Frankfurt kitchen, often described as a one-off collaboration between the two movements. However, calling for women's input was more common than we believe. Many world exhibitions hosted competitions calling on women to design homes, like this one. Inspired by a book published in 1896, The House That Jill Built, When Jack Proved to Be a Failure. These women were not after cozy, textured interiors, but rather something smooth and easy to clean, completely flipping the gender perspectives on the aesthetics of the home. Not much more must be said to see the similarities between the home economics movement and the functional minimalism proclaimed by modern architects of the 20th century. So when Le Corbusier, at the beginning of Toward an Architecture, proclaims that the problem of the house has not yet been stated and that the house should be a machine for living in, this is somewhat questionable. Paulette Barnege, home economist in France, dedicated her career to the awareness of the home, Architects obviously did not respond and still had not in 1928 when she published If Women Made Houses. Based on an article published 5 years prior in her 1923 review, she used a series of provocative diagrams to call architects and urban planners to listen to the housewife, to take her in as a consultant. The reciprocity between the two movements existed. Brenege praised the work of Le Corbusier in her 1926 review, and Corbusier is noted present at many home economic conferences. However, rarely are we confronted with the juxtaposition of the two movements. For example, in The New Apartment, The Woman as Creator, published by Bruno Tort in 1924, one would expect for the woman's input in the conception of the new dwelling to be acknowledged, especially that the phrase, woman as creator, is placed 6 times on the cover. Rather, Tort used the pretext, the architect thinks and the woman directs, to justify his title. He describes the old way of living and illustrates its nonsense in the manner of Christine Frederick, altering the plan following her guidelines. As Tort blindly applied a design by women who endorsed and cultivated household labor and states that women still drown in housework, he does not question the very form of the traditional bourgeois dwelling. Rather, he found another problem, coziness, which he described as a primitive neurotic ritual. He's not alone in using terms Freud used to describe women suffering from mental illness. Coziness, for Le Corbusier, is sentimental hysteria. The caption to his proposition reads, still too much furniture, but the housewife thinks it's indispensable. For Tort, the failure of his design is the inhabitant, the housewife. And maybe this is why in the 30s and 40s, modern functionalism was often reduced to as a tool for industrialization and mass production and lost its context of origin, the concern of the housewife. What these women achieved design-wise was at the time that they did extremely honest to their image of family and radical in terms of technical competence. It was a way to keep a healthy home and optimize domestic labor, never presented as a solution to be rid of it. I believe it is important in historiographic terms that their work and input be acknowledged. As modern architects implemented and subsequently appropriated the designs of the home economics movement, they crystallized the gender and class-specific ideologies the middle-class housewife put forward. So the essay ultimately has a historiographic purpose and therefore uncovers the less-known context from which modern domestic functionalism was born.
Thank you, Esther. And finally, for this first grouping, would invite Brian Ho to present Closet Door, Underground Carriage, Pride Barricade. This essay coming from Susan Chai's Political Currency of the Stereotype.
Hi there, let me just share my screen. Can everyone see?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, apologies if I run a little bit over time. I'll try to keep it short. But afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be talking about how the conception of queer spaces began in the South and is based around the transgression of established norms. I begin the discussion with an anecdotal account of a visit to a gay bathhouse in central London. Passing through a discreet red door, a receptionist explains the rules of the bathhouse and charged me £1 and handed me a towel. A set of stairs led down to a changing room, which was part of a much larger double height space. Changed into nothing but just a towel wrapped around my waist, I proceeded down into the hall where over 50 men sat chattering and bathing in the hot tub, all the whilst gazing at whoever enters the space, like predators watching their prey enter into their arena. Beyond this hall, another set of stairs led down to a maze. Here, the lights were dim and the corridors were narrow. It was a maze, but one full of sweat and literal steam. On top of this sensorial overload were hands reaching out to grab you, intimate but not close enough to become invasive unless one reciprocates. Whilst there were cubicles for those who desired more privacy, there were also moments where the walls of the labyrinth opened up to accommodate the scene of an orgy. As I left the bathhouse, having lost all conceptions of time, I turned a corner through a short passage and within 30 seconds reached the center of Oxford Street. jammed with jovial Christmas shoppers and confused tourists. The phantasmagoric spaces of the bathhouse cannot be further away. The queerness of the bathhouse stems from the anonymity and transient natures of the encounters that occur within. While it is just a stone's throw away from Oxford Street, it also artificially recreates the feeling of being in a liminal, marginal sector of the city. I argue that the queer individual's search for privacy and publicness is characterized by the lack of both these notions in the home and in the city. Beginning at the home, the closet constitutes an interior within an interior. As a physical space, the use of the closet within cinema is notable in its frequency in which it directly addresses the performance of sexuality. As a voyeuristic space where the protagonist hides inside the closet, gazing onto the enactment of scenes of gore, while simultaneously being shielded in secrecy. The closet therefore constructs a space beyond the room, a storage compartment in which the only occasion for human occupation is for a very primal state of retreat from vulnerability. It challenges the conception of the bedroom as the ultimate private interior space, for it is still a space for display, a space curated for an audience. To address this dilemma, architects have sought to reframe domestic spaces as a kind of bodily covering, such as Erdolf Loew's bedroom for his wife, which was conceived as a bag of fur covering the body. Or Horace Gifford's modernist homes on Fire Island, where the largely homosexual inhabitants are provided with a platform for the performance of hedonistic indulgences. Henry Urbach describes the closet as a space that houses things that threaten to soil the room, just as queer identities threaten the stability of heteronormative domestic space. The architectural relationship between the room and the closet thus determines the conflict and struggle between the two spaces. In relation to queer theory, the contemporary narrative of the LGBTQ plus community has been largely shaped by the gay liberation movement of the 20th century, whereby self-determination of civil rights could only be attained through the act of coming out of the closet. This has inevitably pushed certain elements of queer culture into the public eye, turning the threshold of the closet as a space that can be commodified, such as the so-called pink dollar and pink tourism that governments seek to promote. Unlike the politics of coming out, cruising consists of a more covert operation of gay self-disclosure. Whilst the opening of the closet door signifies a legitimate acceptance of sexual identity by mainstream society, communicating sexual interest while cruising signifies a more dangerous territory of illegitimacy. Metro rear is a portmanteau of the words metro and rear and describes an unlikely queer space that has emerged in Mexico City's rapid transit system. During late nights and especially weekends, the last carriage of each train becomes an ad hoc bedroom for gay men seeking sexual encounters, with many literally carrying out sexual acts in the space of the carriage. According to local rights activists, in the year that Mexico City legalized same-sex marriage, the city also began a stringent crackdown on the phenomenon by closing the last few carriages during late nights. However, cruisers simply moved to other parts of the train. It became a game of chicken between the authorities and queer revelers. In London, a similar situation came into public eye in 2019. When three men were charged for public indecency as a video circulated online of them having intercourse on a Northern Line train passing through busy central stations in the presence of other passengers. The queerness here differs from that of Mexico City, where the main objective was to stay out of sight. The Londoners reveled in the fact that they transgressed norms of public behavior and initially got away with it, as a sort of playfulness that Susan Sontag see as a defining feature in the culture of camp. These elements of camp are often seen as being at odds with a contemporary commodification of queer culture. Much like a closet holding messiness in abeyance, sexuality is only accepted as a cultural product so long as the undesirable consequences of it are sifted out. The spatial implications of this shift in queer culture are most prominent in London's Pride Parade, where barricades are used to mediate physical confrontations between political protest and policing. Now separates the spaces of the performer, which are the corporate sponsored floats, and the spectator, the hundreds of thousands of locals and tourists who flock to see the parade. The performativity of pride is no longer one of active engagement or participation, but one of spectatorship. Attendees fulfill the role of an audience, not as activists or protesters. The thresholds of this queer place, originally dynamic and undefinable, are now spatially bound by metal barricades and temporally bound by the organizer's specific schedule. The space of the parade, so rigidly defined, is akin to a modern theater stage, an elevated platform beyond the reach and scope of the audience. The stage also provides another canvas, one for the capitalist machine to extract value out of contemporary identity politics. The examples I've given today illustrates merely a fraction of the nuances of a vastly underexplored field from the perspective of architectural and urban studies. But to provide a brief summary, firstly, queer spaces had long been and still are ignored, suppressed, and swept under the rug in order to sustain the capitalist structures of heteronormative domestic reproduction. Once the closet door to queerness has been opened and the orderly cleanliness of the room as a metaphor for society is disturbed, it will be closed again, just as authorities seek to rid of Mexico City's cruisers. And just as Pride has shown us, where corporate sponsorship enables the event to multiply and scale, but also on the flip side, results in the sanitation and censorship of queerness. Thus, to conceive a queer space is to constantly negotiate the relational properties between the room and the closet, the curated and the masqueraded. Thanks. That's the end of my presentation.
Thank you, Brian. I'd like to turn to the panel. We've had three presentations, diverse topics, and media interwoven with these. So we have many critics today, and as I said, several papers to walk through. So I'll ask our critics to target their comments, but open the floor to the panel, and we can address any paper in any order, but I'll turn it over to the panel to negotiate which they'd like to speak to first. Anyone can start. Joaquin?
Okay, let's start. I was just, I'll share a little anecdote on the first paper with Maite, because I recall I translated Didi Huberman's text to Portuguese. I published it in Portuguese. And at the time, L'homme qui marchait dans la couleur, I remember that Didi Huberman only communicated through facts. It's just a piece of lovely media archaeology. We would send the translation by fax. You'd annotate, send the fax back. And it was fairly incredible, this other materiality of communication that I think would be important. I thought it was a good story to share about this materiality of light, space, color, and all those behaviors in the work of Didi Huberman.
Thank you, Joaquin.
Maybe I had a kind of thematic question, I guess, a little bit, just maybe to the first two speakers, but possibly a little bit to the last speaker as well. And it was in relation to the idea of sensory deprivation. And all those essays speak very poetically, I think, and analyze very philosophically aspects of being exposed to sensory overload or sensory deprivation, or both. And I wondered, looking through your bibliography, your footnotes, is there another kind of area that you could look at, you could expand out into, look at how basically studies of human response to these kind of aspects. So how does the brain react under sensory deprivation? I think there's quite a scientific literature of studies of brain reactions. And I just felt that while it was very philosophical and very creative writing, I felt that you could have added a little aspect there, a little bit more, a broader literature survey that might add another element.
I can add some comments to all of them. First of all, in reading not just these, but all the papers, each of the shortlisted, I think, represents almost a genre. So it's very, very difficult to, well, compare. We're not here to compare them or to appreciate them, but we have really almost a sampling of what it means to write a paper, write, illustrate, produce, let's say. And in particular, in this session, I think maybe all of them, maybe less so in the domestic space one, they could be simply they could be movies. They could be videos. They have this journey, this narrative which can be interrupted or manipulated by the author. But the interesting shared characteristic, I think, is this taking us for a moment, for a short journey. What they also have in common, and I would like to hear maybe from the other critics, my impression is that they take us almost by the hand and they make us visit these ideas and these spaces without a beginning and without an end. It's as if they were exposing us or punching us maybe, and we are left to find out where we started from and where it ends, which for me personally, it's a very positive thing. It's a strength because it produces, it forces us to interact in a very active way. But I just wanted to know what the others think about this.
I will also agree that it's a positive. I quite like the open-endedness of a written piece that poses questions. It's a personal thing, but it's nicer when I'm left with an essay in which I start to think about things, I question things, and I think all the papers really did that. I think for me, just thank you for the students that presented and wrote the papers. They're equally different and really well done. I appreciate that and I enjoyed the presentations. I guess in terms of that open-endedness, and I mean, I have a couple of comments. One for Maite. I think there is a philosophical aspect to your paper, but I actually think there's another philosophical layer within the paper that you can begin to explore and maybe expand out the bibliography. I heard a lot of sort of connections to the sublime, to Kant, this kind of widespread spaces, linking it to landscape, which of course has sort of links to discussions about painting and things like Turner. And I think also with Rothko and sort of the emotional aspect of those paintings that I think Ed is touching upon. And I would suggest looking at Deleuze's writing on Francis Bacon. In your conclusion, you talk about sort of the blank canvas and this kind of openness and what that has an effect on in terms of both psychological as the painter, but also the spaces of the canvas. And I think that could really open it up to a different aspect. But I really like the connection between the landscape and the public space. I think that was really quite clear. And then for Brian, I'm quite curious. I liked how you brought it around to, let's say, Barclays and capitalism and sort of how that has transformed actually the political agenda gay movement from the 60s and onwards to today. I'm wondering if you are aware of or explored at all what happened during COVID when so many companies in London actually were trying to sell off their rainbow flag merchandise and signage that they usually put out to actually get customers and look like they're supporting the movement. But they were selling it because obviously during COVID, there were a lot of rainbow flags going up around to support NHS. And I think it's another example of like that capitalist kind of latching onto the gay movement or any other sort of a movement for sort of financial gain. And I think it shows sort of another dark side to that. And I think spatially, I think darkness is also something within the closet, within going down into spaces, toilets, right, of sort of public toilets being used in that way. And I think, and maybe this is what Ed was talking about, but I think the role of darkness within a lot of the spaces you explore is also quite important, and maybe can it be expanded on, but thank you.
I'm gonna follow Ryan, and I'm gonna speak on behalf of Ryan, because I think he haphazardly put in a conclusion about COVID that I didn't know of, and then it wasn't really explored. But he was talking about kind of people picking up on COVID and then people inadvertently going against the politic, which the urban space that kind of behaves. It wasn't exploring the essay, but it was contemporary. So I think, you know, in Ryan's comments, it was quite important. And then, you know, for future investigation, I think I'm just gonna say a few comments that I saw when I heard the four essays. I love how Brian's essay immediately followed Esther's about the cleanliness of home. I thought it was perfect. I don't know if it was intentional, but it was perfectly paired. I think you guys should talk some more and then see where you meet on these polar opposite way of, because it's about, in my head, it's about the same topic. Well, Brian maybe is more urban in the conventional definition, but it's about the same topic, but in completely different perception, which I think is enormously interesting and talk about, kind of shows the scope of both the writing and history and theory in architecture. The earlier two essays, I think my reflection is this. I think Maite, sorry, I don't know if I pronounced that right. Maite's way for me is like, it's something about the plaza I haven't heard, in the sense it's universal. Because I always think of plaza as culturally specific with the monumental building around it. And then you seem to take those away from the culture for better, and then you put it in an almost sightless situation and look at the unifying nature of the actual function of the plaza, which I saw was quite special. And then on the other hand, Neil, oh God, I'm so sorry if I pronounce it wrong, Neil Fetos?
Neil.
Yeah, hi, Neil. And Neil's, which was, even though the music scene and DJ is transcendental, I don't know if that's probably the right word, it's extremely specific, right? And then you went into depths about how it's utilization of movement. So I follow all the jurors. Congratulations on everybody's good work, and then it will be quite hard to choose. But I'm so thrilled to see the range of topics and the ways of investigation.
Thank you, Susan.
May I add just a couple of, more than anything, I just took a couple of notes of things that I thought would make sense to interact with those essays. Because for Brian, I was just jotting down all those notes, all the exploration that Andrés Jacques did with the superpowers of 10, and how basically how identities were in print and stereotyped, even in film, in camera film, and how all those things were producing different images and different interactions with capital and within society. I was remembering for Esther, I was very, of course, there's a lot of people that are big, big fans of things like the Grand Domestic Revolution, you know, that Dolores Aden plays exactly, that main cycle of all the changes in work and energy that modern architects so well absorbed, you know? Especially Frank Lloyd Wright, evidently, you know? And the old school Banham tells the story, Gideon tells the story very, very well too, you know? But how was the trade-off? And even Adrian, you know? In Objects of Desire, Adrian makes this point also very, very curiously. You know? And The one for Neophytus, I was very curious because I was writing down how the heck you are dialogical and immersive at the same time. Mm. Do we want spectacle or do we want the party? No, how? I was always remembering, because it's of course our own old school DNA. You know, we love workshops, and remember that old crazy John Littlewood invented the workshop to torn down the separation, the hierarchies between, you know, just audience and performance. So I was very, very curious of what is exactly the displacement between immersiveness and a dialogical situation. And sorry, I'll keep this as short as I can.
Thank you, Joaquin. Kathy, you had your hand?
Yes, I just want to echo what other critics have said in saying that the range of topics and the papers were so impressive to me. So it's wonderful to see all this work being done, and I congratulate you, especially while libraries are closed and such. I see them grouped in two categories, the MITs and NAO. You were, both looking at this kind of intersection between cities and artworks and public spaces. And I love, MITi, that you used Terrell's crater because the way it's sort of like a secret in the landscape, even when you drive, if you've driven by it, it's like you wouldn't know what happens in there. And NAO, I love your project, and this idea that you said, the quote that I wrote down, galleries and museums dissolve into the city fabric. And I think we're at a time now where we're, curators and artists are looking for new ways to kind of get out of galleries and museums and into spaces of city and how they do that. And I think this is absolutely connected to the culture we're living in, which is one, especially in this country, of protest and sort of civil unrest that we haven't seen in like 50 years. Esther and Brian, I love your work. I thought it was very interesting. Esther, of course, very specific to the literature you looked at and the time that the housewives were female. And Brian, you looked at spaces and I saw mostly male queer. And I wondered if there was a kind of correlative space for female queer. And then I also wanted to push both of you into thinking about the kind of in-between and to look at the work maybe in your future work, look at the writing and the curatorial work of people like Paul Preciado, who's talked about resisting corporate and capitalistic culture by existing between genders. And largely that's a pharmacological development that we have in the 21st century, where we can exist, pharmacological and surgical between genders. But I was so impressed with these papers. And I'll keep it short, but I just want to say, I think, especially Esther and Brian, it would be super interesting to bring this research, push it even further in your future work into this idea of trans culture, which is certainly a big new topic, which actually draws a lot from gender studies and feminist work. But thank you to all the presenters.
Thank you, Kathy. Esther, I was particularly taken with your research. I just wanted to make a reference for you, much in the way Ryan offered a few references. A colleague and an external member on the Teaching and Learning Committee, Barbara Penner, recently completed a book on the Cornell Kitchen, which is one of those iconic studies. But it's post-war, and it's linked up to an American take on the same and its relationship to agriculture. So I think as this topic expands, I think you can unpack the entire world through the keyhole of these kitchen studies. And I think you're really onto something. So to echo Kathy's point, there's a little PhD in every essay, and there's more to do. I'm sure Barbara would be more than happy actually to meet with you and discuss your paper specifically. Any other comments from the panel? We're doing rather well, actually, for time. Anyone who hasn't had an opportunity to speak yet from the panel?
Okay. Can I make one comment for Esther?
Sure.
Esther, one thing I really enjoyed about your piece is that all the research is very historical, right? And yet somehow you've transformed that into a very contemporary and current piece of work, and that's not easy to do. So I was really impressed with that. And I don't know if this is a good reference or not, but I kept thinking that one reference that might not tie things together, but might bring some of the layers that you discussed in the paper was Maison de Verre, because you talked about sort of the movement cleanliness, right, and disease, right? Also, there's all the mechanisms in that house try to, you have to contextualize them historically to break down certain social barriers. But also Le Corbusier visited that house like weekly when it was under construction. So it might be just something to look at to see if you think it fits with the continuation of the research.
I didn't actually hear the name.
Maison de Verre. I'll put it in the chat.
Okay, Maison de Verre.
Yeah.
No, I remember all the lectures in the second year, first year that you did.
Right, yeah.
And before we conclude this session, just wanted to open it to the floor in general. If anyone outside of the panelists had a comment across these papers, it would be nice to hear from you.
I think Ed wanted a quick follow-up.
Right.
Did I get that wrong? I saw a gesture.
Thank you.
Esther, it's just another reference, another one. It was really, really interesting figure of Margaret Willis, who's a sociologist at the LCC Architects Department, and who had a huge amount of input into the design of a lot of the post-war, the big estates, but whose name has been kind of pretty much eclipsed, partly to do with the LCC, the way the archive has been catalogued, that a sociologist and a woman her work was kind of, but as a subsection of the work of the architects. But she's a really, really important figure to look up on, chase up on as well.
Thanks, Ed. Thanks, panel. Off we go into round two. I promised a comfort break. What I'd like to do is actually, if you don't mind, charge through the next presentations and then take a proper break before we see the last. Is that agreeable to everyone? All right. So if we can turn the floor over to Amy Glover, The Failure of the Fens, coming out of Dennis McShane's The Coming Crisis of Britain's Future.
Hello. My neighbor has just put down his hedge trimmer, so I really hope it doesn't start up again. But if you can't hear me, please let me know.
That's a fen kind of trouble.
Can you see full screen?
Yes.
Okay. So the essay looks at the fens, which are an area of lowland stretching inland from the Wash estuary. And it first dissects a series of dichotomies by which the fen landscape has been governed until today. For thousands of years, the fens have been manipulated into a state of artificial stability driven by the drainage of land in order to make it arable. And the enclosures of the 17th century intensified this process, paid for by private landowners. The essay looks at the close relationship between dryness and ownership, and how a network of drainage infrastructure pumping water out into the Wash spatially marks edges of territory across the landscape is maintained in order to consolidate ownership over the land and to maximize its value through production. Despite efforts to fix the land and make it predictable, however, the opposite is happening. Peat shrinkage means that land is sinking and the dry soil is shifting. Fen blow is the occurrence of strong winds whipped up over the flat plains of the fens, causing storms that carry the dry topsoil in large clouds across the landscape. This surface layer, blown out of its usual dimension and into the area usually occupied by sky, ignores boundaries of territory and ownership. It ignores ditches and rivers and roads. Previously flat, it becomes temporarily voluminous, a dark billowing haze blurring edges between ground and sky. dry land has as much fluidity as wetland. The term Fenish is one of the many words used to refer to the people of the Fens. And like many wetland communities around the world, the Fenish have been seen as outsiders throughout history, characterized by myth and folklore surrounding their changeable landscape and its mysterious weather phenomenons. This is Fenrir, the monstrous wolf from Norse mythology, whose name means bog or fen dweller. Before the 18th century, the Fens were associated with disease, and the perception from the outside was that they had bad air about them. James Boyce refers to the draining of the Fens at various points in their enclosure as an imperial, the draining of the Fens at various points as an imperial act, dispossessing land from the Fenish people who had been tied to it for centuries, and drainage became a tool for purifying the land and its people. Today, however, the flat, fertile ground of the Fens is the most important area for crop production in the UK. And despite being reliant on the thousands of people who have located there from mainland Europe and work in agriculture, horticulture, and food packing, in the 2016 referendum, the Fens voted overwhelmingly to leave the EU. The essay looks at the possibility of a correlation between leaf strongholds and lowland areas all over the UK, and dwells on the suggestion that this could, in part, stem from the uncertainty and lack of solidity that runs throughout the landscape itself. The memories of past and continuous efforts to colonize the Fenish landscape are materialized in the landform itself and in the remnants of the infrastructure that facilitate exploitation. Be it in the form of roddens, vast ridges of silt built up along the traces of Roman infrastructure, or in the form of a measurement device turned memory marker from the 1800s, kept in place through the Conservation Act of Propping. The Fen landscape is scattered with these immortalizations of its own trauma, contributing on another layer to what Richard Mabey has described as a new rural aesthetic defined by the traces of human activity left around the countryside. One of the most unique features of the Fens are the inland islands that punctuate the vast flatness. And these are not actual islands, but rather slightly higher ground, only rising up to around 30 meters above sea level, towards which settlements have gravitated over time. And one such is the Isle of Ely, with its famous cathedral towering over the flat surroundings. Each island has its own spire, a reminder of the institution that once overhauled the management of the Fens, now echoed by the power lines and industrial chimneys visible in every direction. There is a feeling of isolation about the Fens, as if it itself were an island in the rest of the UK. The essay hopes to draw attention to the connection between this and the landform itself, its manipulation, use, and the perception from the outside. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. If we could turn to Carl Herdisch and his paper, The Rustic Tradition, related by virtue of trees to the last, this coming from Melissa Moore's course, Trees in London.
Perfect, so I'm just gonna share my screen one second. So first of all, I must acknowledge and thank Melissa directly because not only for the nomination, which is actually a bit of a surprise, but also because of the ongoing lectures and discussions. Her lectures were very particular because they were a series of associations, at first seemingly disconnected ponderings, but there was an openness to the approach to knowledge gathering and sharing that this piece of writing really kind of steps up off. So the rustic tradition is an interconnected series of multiple elements, narratives, autobiographical elements, and histories. And it weaves and constructs its sense through the use of this form of storytelling. And as a process, I'm going to talk about the process. I started off with two images. Firstly, a diagram of how a relief was to be used to reimagine and engineer and innovate and mechanize the English landscape itself for preparations for railway tracks to be laid across the country. and secondly, a peculiar image from some holiday snaps that increasingly haunted our conversation as Melissa and I spoke throughout the term. A few friends and I had decided to go on a narrowboating holiday at the end of the first lockdown. And well, if you can call it a holiday, it was a lot of 130 locks. And it's something the narrowboating holiday has been something that I've always been very skeptical of. And as you can see, traveling down the canal, it basically is an exposition of domestic life along the Trent and Mersey. And I found that very fascinating. It's a peculiar voyeuristic condition where you get an insight into life along the canal. So between the gnomes and also ad hoc garden pubs, which I think were probably set up way before the lockdowns, I think they seem to be a crucial element to the English landscape. You get a stage presence and you gain an insight into the regional English way of life. And it's a way of life that, in all honesty, I'd shut out for many years living in London, and that somehow came back to haunt me during this trip and during the writing of The Rustic Tradition as a text. Yet I barely write about these two images. And when I began to write, I didn't really feel the need to describe the two images. They just existed alongside the text, which was intriguing. So I'm just going to make a broad stroke of the essay to try and make sense of it for some clarity's sake. There's really four main ideas that developed as I wrote within the ambience of those two images. These four elements are the roots of the text. And as I wrote it, it took me on a journey, a sort of narrative journey as I was writing it. And what you can see here is a simplification of this movement, maybe the geography of how I wrote the text. But to continue this analogy, this became maybe a condition of tree trunks or the areas of nodes which I could write around. And that brought a proliferation of parts anchored to them, a branching out of these narratives. And this can all seem very serious. I need to share a video with you.
The moment I decided to sell my hope of escaping the realities of city living occurred after a week of unfortunate events. On Boxing Day at 3 a.m, I fell out of bed and woke. At first I believed this to be some sort of prolonged side effect of Christmas booze, but after using my wall to step back onto my bed, only to slip off again, I realised my boat was rotated on its side. Scrambling out onto the towpath in minus temperatures in my boxes, I had confirmed that my boat was not sinking to the canal bed, that all the water had been drained in its entirety, revealing a scene of complete carnage under the moonlight. I could make out a trolley, children's bike, and the wheels of a moped. For the boater, London is still a city in direct contact with your own filth.
We wanted time out.
Time out as opposed to time off, as it felt like time had disappeared.
Or at least blurred by an onslaught of 6-hour Zoom calls, followed by a wine or whiskey haze to mark the end of that toad called work. Punctuated throughout the day by sex sessions or frustrating drought off. I'm haunted by a childhood of holiday memories, vast complexes or tourist traps. One of the most embarrassing that must be committed to writing has to be Benidorm, where my brother and I became victims of another awful sickness known as Englishness. My grandfather repeatedly forced us to wear Union Jack bandanas as we traversed from the hotel to the beach. Lunch was pepperoni pizza, and dinner a seaside meal. Utter shite, barely edible.
Yeah, thank you. That's. I'll end there.
We're moving to Paul Vesci's presentation of the local studio lens, Politics as Mood Picture, working with.
I cannot believe our vacation is over.
I know. Now we have to go back home to Hawaii.
Paul, is that your presentation?
Ladies and gentlemen, if you could just stay seated with your seatbelts fastened. It's going to be a bumpy ride for a little bit.
I think it's actually, do you still have the browser open? It might just have gone to the next video after Carl's.
That was fun. Thanks. It's not a bumpy ride at all. We're smooth sailing on AA Air. Over to you, Paul. Your paper coming from Joaquim's course, Learning Again from Television.
Hi, thank you. So the text I'm going to present is a reflection on a piece of video that was broadcast in 1972. And that video shows the opening ceremony of a new local television studio. And I'm interested in that studio as a space of displacement. And I was going to try to connect it to a couple of branches. So the first one would be that it seems to prepare the ground for a transition in television towards what Umberto Eco later, 10 years later, calls neo-television, or what we commonly refer to as kind of reality, and in the sense that the local studio is really a crucial piece of infrastructure in that transition. And if we follow Eco's central point that reality television manages to hide its artifice exactly by placing it in front of the camera, in the sense that because we see the camera, we take whatever is in front of the camera to be real, I think we can apply much the same logics to the architecture of the studio, because that same version takes place there, whereby every element seems to suggest to explain its function to us, but it really doesn't. And I've tried to link that in the essay to the architect being a cartoonist, because that kind of moment seems to be very similar, the kind of exaggeration of essence to the praxis of the cartoonist. Anders explains a dynamic in television of imitation of one's own image as television becomes a sort of mass medium. This circular copying in anticipation of being broadcast was crucial for my understanding of the second part of the clip. In this clip, we see politicians giving speeches, sounding in a sense exactly like those given today. And with the detachment of 50 years, that kind of question of imitation almost becomes inverted. As we are detached from what we're seeing, the differentiation between them being politicians and them acting almost becomes meaningless, which is exactly what Anders alerts us to. And with that ambivalence in mind, I wished to reconsider the text, A Study of Brecht by Benjamin, which is sort of one of these introductory texts of around the epic theater. Perhaps in the epic theater, we find a sibling of sorts of neo-television, both because they somehow share roots in the radio. In television, that's obvious, and in epic theater, the dramaturgy of radio is also kind of explicitly referred to. And I tried to articulate, despite that degree of similarity, the crucial difference, which for me lies at once in the term Verfremdung, estrangement, and also in the fact that the consideration towards the social role in the epic theater is absolutely central. So if I wish to condense it, I think one could use the quote of Benjamin, the one that shows shall be shown, and say that in the case of the epic theater, that means more than the cameraman. I just thought maybe I'll show 2 minutes of the clip. That would work.
Was wir uns bezüglich des Fernsehens wünschen, ist eine entsprechend Objekt. Und auch die Berücksichtigung der Das aus dem Rundfunk Volksbegehren entstandene Rundfunkgesetz des Jahres 1967 schuf für die Tätigkeit the letters endlich für ein Resultat einer traditionell ausgeübten Toleranz und der Achtung anderer Meinungen, dass es in Oberösterreich keine Meinungsverschiedenheiten zwischen den Parteien oder Gruppen gibt, die den Rundfunk in diesem Bundesland betreffen. Wir wissen aber, dass kein Werk und keine Tätigkeit fruchtbar und wertvoll werden kann, wenn nicht du als Schöpfer und Herr deinen Segen spendest.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And lastly, a presentation for this set from Tamir Ahroni. Which Villa Savoy are you today? Coming out of Will Orr's Necromancing the Stone course.
Hello, I'll just quickly share the screen.
Sorry, just to clarify, that was a joint submission. Is that right, Tamir? Joint submission. Will or Necromancing the Stone and Ricardo Rivo's, remind me the course title.
Against Obstruction.
Thank you. Just to give the, sorry.
Thank you.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay. So my essay is called Which Villa Savoy Are You Today? An Inquiry into the Mimetic Transformation of Architecture. The title comes from this meme that shows nine versions of Villa Savoy. The essay examines a few case studies that show different attitudes towards copying. It begins with Hallstatt, an Austrian village that was secretly cloned in China, and a Zaha Hadid project that was copied by pirate architects also in China. When Hallstatt was described as a whole new level due to the reproduction scale, Zaha's duplicate defies once again the ability to replicate, as the copy was completed 1 year before the original due to the speed of construction. Critics have criticized the Chinese replicas for their staggering lack of innovation, comparing them to fake designer brands. Studies also argue that it is in the Chinese tradition of thematic appropriation, and that the ancient parallels of these copycats suggest that they are monumental assertions of China's global primacy. While this argument sits well within the fear of China's increasing power, it ignores completely how Western architecture has evolved throughout history. My favorite example of that is Mies and his many imitators. It seems that Mies's reputation grew precisely because of his ability to be copied. Looking at the plan of Zaha's project reveals that she was also inspired by him. Zaha uses the same logic in structure as Mies, but hides it behind an iconic envelope. But Zaha copying Mies and the Chinese firm copying Zaha is not the same, because Mies was designed to be copied and Zaha was designed to pretend to be unique, creating value through image branding. Ironically, copying Zaha reveals the true nature of architecture, of the architecture of uniqueness as mere aura. And by revealing the aura, it breaks it. One solution for the branding problem in architecture has been ironically introduced by OMA. They proposed a generic looking tower attempting to end the era of meaningless overdose of themes, extremes, egos, and extravagance. However, OMA's proposal, wide and flat like an image of the UN Tower in New York, is just another commercial tower with a veneer of modernism. The generic tower uses its characterless as a character, and it gains its identity by attempting to stand out among the surrounding towers. We've already seen the strategy of rebranding an existing icon in Rehm's copy of Villa Savoy, version number 3. This essay argues that there are similarities between the evolution of icons in architecture and the mimetic transformation. Digital memes express the changing logic of creation and authorship and challenge the subtle interaction between creators and their artifacts. Mimetic distributions intensifies the tension between artworks' prestige and the mundane ability to copy, distribute, and even change or disrupt them. They are often characterized by the internet ugly aesthetics that normalize flawed and unpolished appearance while mocking mainstream conventions. The very act of artistic creation and the genius it stands for are mimicked here. Although memes are connected to the digital sphere, this piece by Marcel Duchamp could be considered a very early classical art meme. This gesture is understood as a parody of the icon. Alongside their entertaining, whimsical, and often sloppy nature, memes provide an avenue for political and civic participation. Villa-Savoye's 9 versions show appropriation as well as displacement by compressing, reproducing, and remixing. Despite their substandard resolution, the different interpretations embody the afterlife of the conserved and protected masterpiece. While the original stays the same age, its new images as its proxies travel and become uglier and uglier. The essay proposes to adopt copying as a tool against branding by wearing off the aura. Reproduction, being horizontal and anti-hierarchic, can be a way to democratize and even allow for a participatory culture of the icon. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tamir. And I think we all appreciate the aura and originality of your background. Nice touch. Could I welcome Tim Iverson, who's joining the panel. Tim, good to see you.
Yes, hi.
And open the second set of papers up to the panel for discussion. Anyone who would like to kick off?
Yeah, I have a comment or a question, actually. Let's put it as a question. So thank you all, of course, for your presentations. I have a question which is just around the kind of writerliness or the writerly usage of description. Or descriptiveness, which seems to me in the first two presentations or the first two papers, something that they rely on in terms as a type of exploration or exposition of the topic in which they're dealing with. So I'm just wondering for Amy and Carl, if you'd like to say something around what it is to write on the topic through such a highly descriptive form and the manipulations you're able to produce through that.
Maybe I'll start. I think the thing that was fascinating from both the series with Melissa and then going on with the writing and just being descriptive is often when I started writing about the thing itself, it would open up a series of other associations and other peculiarities that I could then write about and explore. So it became, to describe the thing itself became a method in which I could write very quickly and start to make a series of associations that I maybe did not make before. And so the process of writing itself became actually very enjoyable because I didn't know what to expect. I had no idea I was going to write that text when I first started writing. And so through description or just simply starting with the thing itself and making associations between those different elements that somehow ended up connecting, it became very, very exciting actually to write. I don't know about reading it, that's another matter, but
I think it's similar for me. I think it helps me create connections and as a way to start kind of viewing, I guess, maybe quite previously disparate points in the history of the Fens could be brought out, and I kind of almost saw them like characters that you could maybe describe in order to create a story and some kind of link between them.
Okay, thanks. Because I mean, it strikes me that in both your works, and certainly in the way you presented them, there's a kind of thinking through writing, to put it obviously. But within that, there's a kind of an acknowledgement of the way in which writing operates at such a kind of painful pace, the kind of agonizing attempt to try and formulate something in that way, then naturally always leads to kind of deviations from it, which in, you know, both your cases, as you described, is really productive, precisely because in a sense, trying to exhaust the subject means that it forces you off in directions in order to maintain a kind of interest or grapple with what it is to try and convey things in that manner. So thank you both.
I'd like to say something about reading these papers. And again, all of them, all the shortlisted, congratulations, because you do write very well. That's probably obvious. I mean, you wouldn't be here otherwise, but you write very differently as well. In particular, Carl, I don't know, I would call your work a sort of a memoir of the now, in the sense that it could almost be redone again and again and again. Memoir of the now in marigolds. About the style, I started to read your paper and I was thinking, where is he going? And this is not really scholarly, is it? That was my first. But then you got me, because I realized that it didn't matter where you were going, but it was more what you were looking at on left side, wherever, along the canal, this fictional canal, really. And then maybe it is the writing Mark was talking about. But I know we're not judging now, but I really wish to congratulate you, because at some point I wasn't reading, and it's surreal to be reading while not reading. And that means that, I don't know if it's a personal thing, again, this is beyond quality of the writing, it's really personal styles. At some point I wasn't reading, which is really weird in a text which is also typed really, really densely. So it was obvious to see your video. And I think, Amy, you do it almost instead. You are talking about a territory, but you're doing it in time. It's as if you were taking photographs of the same place, but in different moments to show different things. So you don't move, so it's a completely different style. So I don't want to talk about all the papers. I mean, it's just to keep the discussion off, possibly.
Thank you, Teresa. Carl, Teresa spoke to the words. I'd like to speak to the video you presented. It immediately reminded me of a peer of mine, Ian Nairn, who I think would deliver conversations around the same sorts of sites you're interested in. Subtopia, he called it. He coined the phrase. These kind of dreary suburban moments, but also places of discovery. And if you haven't watched Ian Nairn, you delivered rather like him. You'd have to gain some weight and have a massive drinking problem to be just like him. But I think that sense of how you bridge writing and then present it in a format like Ian did on television, like you're doing on video, and to take that in its own space was an interesting, I think, addition to the essay itself. So I quite like the video project and would encourage more.
Can I add another reference to Carl, just to hop on the train? But I think Mark Morris was topic specific. It popped in my head when you were presenting the video. There's a show called All Gas No Break on YouTube, which is entirely different from your topic, because that one's about Americana and then by nature more bizarre. But the way that you present it, like, you know, I think Mark Campbell noted it earlier, that it was explored. So everything started out normal and started like slowly deviates. A bit actually, you know, Amy's topic as well, talking about the fangs. It slowly deviates into something almost unrecognizable, but even though everything else looks extremely natural. So I think for me, that's, I'm trying to put in my head what is about the two kind of presentation style, but usually All Gas No Break is being credited as kind of contemporary de Gonzo journalism. So the point is at the end is open for interpretation, but the process of which is all open to see. And that process is made through the writing. And then, so that's my random reference.
I also thought of, for Carl's paper, I thought it was, I mean, my immediate reference point was Jonathan Mead's I don't know if anyone else picked up on that, but both of the first papers have this feeling of a kind of journey through the landscape, right? And that's something Jonathan Meads does in like many of his, what are they called? Like abroad and abroad again, and these kinds of things where he's kind of popping up around the landscape of different cities. But yeah, so the first two, I think were, to me, yes, very much journeys through the landscape, but also a journey through ruins in a way. There was a sense of, varying degrees of loss or degradation in terms of the places that the narrative takes us to, whether that's humorous or more kind of a little bit more somber. But I wonder, in terms of that kind of narrative structure, if we just think stay with that idea of a kind of narrative or literary style, it struck me that, you know, both of these journeys seem to have a kind of ambiguous ending. And yet they feel like, even from the beginning, that they're kind of looking at something larger already from the end of it, right? From a kind of vaguely post-apocalyptic perspective. And I wonder if the authors might expand on that a little bit in terms of, you know, by the end of the essay, where are we in a sense? For example, with Amy's essay, the title is very decisive, right? The failure of the fens. But as I was reading it, I was struck that the description is a little bit more ambiguous, right? Because it does seem to be like the fens, I like how exactly would you like us to regard that sense of failure? Whose failure, right? Or how do we locate that failure in this landscape that you've kind of taken us through? And I would ask a similar question of Carl, in the sense, I mean, I like the map that you showed us in the presentation. And that's another thing I would say is that it seems like a lot of these essays are resolved in a much more clear way in the presentations often than the original essays, which is kind of interesting when you're forced to, you know, summarize or abstract. You have to kind of, strengthen your argument to a certain extent, which is kind of interesting. But the map in your case, I think, was really helpful. But again, yeah, where do you think this boat trip kind of takes us? And then for the second two, because I feel like we should give some time to the second two essays, which I thought were also very strong. But if the first two are kind of journeys through a landscape, I mean, I feel like, and really about landscape, the second two to me present very specific questions for architectural practice, right? Or for architectural thinking. And I feel like they both have a certain kind of anxiety. And I wonder if the authors might be able to pinpoint what kind of problem for architecture is this, in a sense, if you had to kind of underline it.
Thank you, Tim. Maybe we could get responses from Paul and Tamir on that pivotal question. I think Tamir talked about branding as an element, but it's probably a lot more than this dialectic.
Yeah, I would say the main question or the problem that the essay tries to bring, especially at the end, was branding and creating value through through image and basically that's it.
I suppose, but to phrase it differently, are you seeing this as an opportunity for architecture or a problem to be addressed? Because in your case studies, you know, they kind of hinge on conflicting ideas about authorship or reproducibility. Are we confronted with a moment of increasing freedom or constraint in that regard?
So that's what I was trying, at least in the essay, to show to show both of these sides through the different examples. So with Mies, for example, the problem of the copying is not a problem, but an opportunity. And the different ways of copying and what they reveal. So the way Zaha is being copied reveals something about Zaha, not less about the copied object. Yeah.
I think as you touch upon, Tamira, it kind of opens up the question that we all seem to strive for as architects is originality. And yet I think what you're actually posing is it doesn't exist, or that nothing is new. And I think that, you know, that's something we are confronted with a lot in what we do and what we actually expect or ask students to do as well, to land on this kind of original piece of research or project. So I think it permeates through all architectural kind of practice and discourse. So I might be interested to see to take it more like also into that direction rather than the object itself, but actually how it sort of affects us as practitioners. But I think, yeah, I mean, to kind of continue some of the discussion, of course, everything is really well written, really impressive, and really nice. I think in this group of four, quite different methods and approaches. I think one thing I enjoyed about Amy's and Carl's was there was a certain level of localism that you were exploring, very much so, but yet you don't really touch upon it. Carl, you do a bit when you start going to Benidorm and these other locations, but it begins to open up questions like, Amy, in your case, of water wars, right? The relocation of community, right? When you extract water from locations, what's happened in Syria, Nigeria, et cetera, when there's drought and what that causes, and the political nature of that. We've seen it in the United States with Los Angeles. And I think so by being so narrow in your focus, somehow you've actually sparked all these other more global potential discussions that's what sparked in my mind. And to pick up on the point from Teresa about you kind of located one area and sort of showed us it in different levels of time, there's a book by Richard McGuire called Here, which actually does that very well graphically and visually. So you maybe want to take a look at that. And I also really like, Carl, how I felt like you, as a protagonist, right, as the character through your piece, were trying to, it was like a moment of discovery, but the way you were trying to do that was very architectural, and that you were placing yourself in unfamiliar contexts, which is what we do a lot with architecture. So I really enjoyed that. It made me think about how we change as individuals when we're in different contexts, or how we're looking for the right context that we maybe fit in. I want to commend you on the video. I mean, I thought it was hysterical, and it brought out, when I was reading the paper, I was like, you know, I really enjoyed the humor, and humor isn't easy in writing. And you used it really well, and to see that then translate into the video, I think was really impressive. So do more of that. And then Paul, I just have one kind of question for you. I think everything you showed, at least at the end, was like a cropped image, right? Focused on the individual giving the speech, or the politician. And I kind of wonder if your argument would change if you kind of remove that frame and investigated a little bit more what was behind it, and what were the armatures to make that scene happen. I think you talk about that in the beginning a bit with some of the references, but then you crop it down to that image. And there was a project in Diploma 12 a couple years ago where they really investigated the space of the newsroom and kind of how they set the stage for that. So just maybe another way to think about what you're working on.
I think maybe I can use that question also for the question Timothy posed, because if I think that if you ask for a problem of architecture that the essay seems to have have raised. And I think maybe one can even put it down to the problem of one building, which is the inverse of the essay, I think, of which is Parliament, in my opinion. I think that the way the TV studio has shaped also the space of Parliament into this kind of demonstrating body of politics, which is merely defined decisions are executed, is quite interesting. And I think it's perhaps the architectural problem is to find a way to pierce through the politics that are happening before that, happening in the bodies that constitute our policy more widely, parties and so on and so forth. So I think actually one can bring down the architectural problem down to one building and question the purpose of Parliament in some sense as it is constituted right now as a building.
May I?
Oh, go ahead.
Okay.
Oh, for the first two essays, I'm currently being very, very happy going through Nick Hayes' The Book of Trespass, which I think is an incredible exercise on that, on a critical immersion through the history of the enclosures and the particular exploitative making of a socio-technical landscape in England. It's very, very good. But what I have to honestly tell everybody, I'm just finding it spectacular, the televisuality of this moment, while we are all watching us, being watched by us, you know? And chatting in the private channels and in the public channels. I think that there are definitely new spaces of this incredible televisuality of this particular moment that it's me pretending doing research, which is the good fact of televisuality. We have to stage and declare everything that we do, otherwise it doesn't register. No, but I think definitely I'm very curious to see how is the other side of these televisual screen scholarship that we are all involved with, no? So I'm very, very curious of how all these experiences of our fictions of every day and how these fictions are biopolitical and how they will come out of these televisuality that we are all immersed in. No, it was just painting the landscape in electronic brushes more than anything.
Thank you, Joaquin. Ed?
Yeah, I just wanted to say really how much obviously I'd enjoyed reading all these four essays and really how much I agreed with everything people have said before. And what I'm left with now are really a kind of array of possibly gentle criticisms is all that I've got left. The kind of positive stuff has been said already. So forgive me, these are really gentle kind of suggestions. Or areas to look at as well, or to think about. And Tamir, maybe if I start with you, fascinating subject. I mean, obviously I'm an archivist, so, you know, in the age of making copies and saving, we're all archiving, we're all doing this on a daily basis. So especially interested in this. But you talk a lot about mimetics, but especially in the essay, you only really get to discussing it really in the final page. And I mean, I'm no expert on mimetics, but my kind of understanding was that it was slightly, how should we say, criticized, or it's slightly controversial science. And there are many, many other kind of information transmission theories which are out there. And I would have been fascinated to kind of see you dig deeper into those information transmission theories, for example. And you know, to criticize, it's very easy to say memes do this, memes do that, but to try and look at it more analytically, more critically, that for me would be a lovely way to continue this study, and I think a really, really fascinating subject. Paul, again, I'm really sorry, it's a kind of really pedantic criticism. I see only five books in your bibliography. Anders writing in 1956, Ecker writing in 1990, and you rely heavily on Benjamin, obviously writing in the 20s and the 30s. I'm sure you've read wider, but express that, kind of show us that. It'd be really interesting to get contemporary theorists take on that. Carl, hugely enjoyable. I love the idea that you take this most direct of routes, the canal, that cuts a straight level line through the landscape, and you use the idea of the washing line, you know, the taut washing line, and then you do the exact opposite, you meander. You do a meander through the landscape. I think that's really lovely. But my criticism would be to go back and to edit and to make sure there are some you talk about Thatcher being responsible for privatization in the 1970s. She wasn't in power. there are a few things like that that you could tighten up on, which would really, really kind of pull that essay together, I think.
I suffer from the inability to self-edit in general. So, yeah.
But it's a great essay. So, like I said, these criticisms are really, really kind of what's left at the bottom of the barrel after the other jurors have kind of taken the rest. And Amy, again, great bit of research. And I mean, just fascinating. My only thought, again, could you weave in some of the context, the broader context? I mean, this is happening in the kind of the context of the agricultural revolution, you know, the Norfolk four course kind of crop rotation. It's a huge context. It's not an isolated thing. There are other communities in other landscapes across Britain that are being similarly affected, similarly colonized, if you like. I know obviously the strength of your essay is in focusing on the local. I just felt a little bit of context in there might have kind of helped. But yeah, sorry, that is the end of scraping the barrel.
Quite enjoyed that. Other comments from the panel? Okay, more open to the floor, and then we'll take that break, I promise. Any comments broadly from the floor?
I have one comment, Mark, for Tamir. Again, congratulations to all of the presenters in this round. And I particularly liked the, Carl, how you became the sort of protagonist in this journey in your presentation, and it became like an artwork. Tamir, I was really interested in your ideas around mimetic transformation. And I thought so much about the fact that in art, in the visual arts, we have a lot of laws protecting copying. And you don't have the same laws in fashion. And now I'm curious about the laws in architecture. I'm guessing maybe when it's overseas, you don't. But one of the things I think about a lot in art and fashion copies is that sometimes the copy is more exciting than the real. There's something about it that feels transgressive. And in art, one of the things that artists do is that there's an equation of how much can be copied from the original. So someone like Jill Magid, who copies a lot of Barragán photographs, books, different things, she's always working with a lawyer to determine how much the artwork can be like the original Barragán letter, whatever, so that Barragán's the people who own Barragán's archive, which long story, but that's the Vitra people. It's not actually in Mexico. Don't sue her. But I was very interested in the legalities around the architecture copy. And I wondered if you could, speak to that a little bit. Are there any legalities? If someone copies your building, can you sue them? And is it like is that a thing, or can people, is it like fashion where people can just go hog wild?
I can say a bit about it. So in the essay I've shown that in the Zaha project that was copied in China, she tried to sue them. Actually, I'll start earlier. There are some legal base for this case, so for suing someone that copies you, that were only developed in the 90s. there are different reasons that people say why it has only been developed in the 90s. Some of them say it's actually because of it was just a bit about after America and China started exchange. And also some say that it's also the same era as the architecture. So these big offices wanted to protect their copyrights. So I've written a bit about it, the Zaha case, where she tried to sue the Chinese developers, but it's a very difficult case to make because what is protected in architecture is the artistic side and not the technical one. And it's many times very difficult to separate what is artistic and what is structural. And specifically with her, the reason she failed to make this case is because the Chinese developer had two towers instead of three, and that was already enough to say that it's not a copy. The only case that I've seen that someone sued and managed was the Le Corbusier Foundation. The Le Corbusier Chapel was also copied in China, and the Le Corbusier Foundation sued them, and they managed not only to get a fine, but also like compensation, but also to remove the building, which is now is a nice backdrop to a barbecue restaurant in China. So that's the only example I know.
I see a book in this for your future. I think it'd be such an interesting, you know, project.
Yeah. Thank you, Kathy and Tamir. I'm getting some text craving that break. I think people do need a little tea break. So I'll grant this. If we could come back at, what do we say, Sylvie, at 10 past, is that a reasonable break? And we'll see the last four papers and have a discussion around them and then panel deliberation. So I would invite you, just turn off your video, but come back at 10 past and we'll pick up the thread. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark.
Before we kick off with this last round, it's worth remembering and to raise a glass, whatever we've got, to Mark Cousins, how much he looked forward to this day, how much he took joy in, and I mean the Sharp Writing Prize and this morning's event as well, how this for him was a highlight of the whole year. And I think his stewardship of these sorts of events has put us in a very good place now to continue that legacy. But it's nice to think of him today and the joy he would have taken from these papers and this dialogue. So I just, want to shout out and keep him in our thoughts as we continue on. I will turn it over to Theo to present his paper, Vibrant. This is coming out of Ricardo Rivo's course Against Abstraction. Over to you, Theo.
Is the rain too loud? I'm not really sure how to. Can you hear the rain?
It's beautifully atmospheric.
Okay, that's perfect then. Where am I? There. If you could just confirm you can see my screen, that would be perfect.
We can.
Yep, looking good.
Okay, as Mark said, this was with Ricardo in Against Abstraction. So I'd like to express my sincerest thanks to Ricardo. So I'll begin speaking about Vibrant. We know what Vibrant is, supposedly, but do we really know what it is? I'll ask again, what is Vibrant? Vibrant is a period of time, pre, mid, and post-gentrification. Vibrant is an ideological first step in the start of the process of gentrification, a quality subjectively projected onto a pre-gentrified reality by gentrifying agents. It's mid-gentrification, the economic annex of the original that now must move. The change is perpetual, the system self-feeding. As one moves, so must another. This is vibrant, rapid movement. If it is a hungry system and the fodder is material, bricks and mortar, then the nutritional value is more contingent, ephemeral, experiential, even informational. So vibrant is post-gentrification, supposed utopianism on a hoarding. New buildings must sell, commodities are cultivated and culture commodified. in visualizations on hoardings and in brochures. Buildings are hidden behind a negligee of lifestyle and buzzwords. Community, creative, historic, authentic, eclectic, vibrant. Enduring terms of a monoculture of preordained vacuity. These are words that bulldoze. What they destroy is most often what they strive to create and sell, the pre-gentrified past. This is a now manufactured vibrancy is plastic. It's something to buy into, not to be a part of. Thus, vibrant is an absence that requires us to look back. It's our obsession. Although it provides a replica of the real thing, it can never be the real thing because its cheap magic is anticipated. Vibrant is London's property market. Buildings are built, bought, sold, and sold again. Apartment buildings, those that hide behind the aforementioned hoardings, are bought off plan, off render, often abroad, to be left empty. They're no longer homes, but instead blocks of money. This isn't liquidity, but it's certainly vibrant, but not the vibrant we expect. Instead, it's the upward march of the investment, 10% a year. The new vibrant is first plastic, second paper, third numeric. It's hidden in the portfolio. Vibrant is avant-gardisms usurped by neoliberalism to make the increasingly small, increasingly cool, think co-living. As you can see here, the political intent of the condenser has been usurped, communal to individual, replaced with a defeatist pessimism that bows to smallness. Privacy is bought. The new communal is a total ideological coping mechanism of opportunity, power lunches and studio apartments. So if vibrant is the imbuing of positive meaning on what is objectively a change for often the worse, then this is to invest with positive meaning what is objectively a decrease in the amount of square meters per capita of domestic space, an ideological shift towards vibrant. This is normal. As with Victorian homes here, the primary stock, we have to extend, repair, make better, or make do. In the wake of the otherwise empty, the small becomes inhabited, extra inhabited, crawling, alive, moving, vibrant. In May 2018, one of the world's largest consulting firms published their findings on London, labelled Vibrant Capital, shaping a city in which Londoners can live, work and grow. Grant Thornton believe in profit for purpose. This is perfect for the city, and they centred it on the city's unique mix of industry, culture and heritage. Though ultimately, they found that the vibrant economy of London is in fact not as dynamic, resilient, healthy, diverse and cohesive as they might have predicted. It's instead unaffordable, driving people to leave, vibrant. They sum this up aptly in the following description of an imagined Londoner, a female, 18 to 30. I bought a handheld back massager as an object that symbolizes London. You need it because living in London is stressful. You're always busy and stressed, and you need a home massager because the cost of living is so high that you can't afford a massage, but need to look for a cheaper solution. Her vibrancy comes from a machine, probably produced in China, plastic. It might well break soon, and it was purchased through Amazon. The simile is emblematic. We must just make do with what we can afford. But this is often something worse, perhaps cheaper. Both can cause a displacement, and both are imbued with a positivity, made acceptable, made vibrant. The backache is gone, but for how long? I think this quote on screen is almost apt, though a bit obtuse. If London is gone, I do wonder where. I think that instead of London disappearing, it's rather lost, constantly changing, in a state of vibrancy. Though it's a city without a map, various roads to take, what to choose. The pull of capital and plastic production is that which presently pervades. What comes next is the insoluble question of hyperreality. Develop, England, patriotism. You choose. What we can say with pride, London is the vibrant capital. Thank you.
Thank you, Theo. Can I turn over to Shaha Maria for her presentation on Beirut, the 4th of August, 2020, work done through Teresa Stepani's Invisibles seminar.
I'm just going to share my screen. Can everyone see all right?
Yes, it looks good.
Yeah, okay. So Beirut, the 4th of August this summer. So through the essay, I tried to make sense of a complex event by framing it with both objective and subjective lenses. Three transforming dust assemblages will be described in the context of the explosion that occurred on that day. They exist in various time frames at different speeds, consisting of different actors. The mundane dust of the city slowly accretes over a long period of time in a chaotic manner. The hazardous dust accumulated in warehouse number 12 in the port of Beirut, whole highly volatile inventory of tons of ammonium nitrate was left exposed for over 6 years in the heat of a Mediterranean port. That warehouse dust took a new form when a spark ignited the chemical, coupling the hazardous with the mundane to forever change the state of the and the character of the city, ultimately invading its personal space. The ammonium nitrate could be described as a latent potency. It was a key part of a web of accumulation of different actors over time, some human, some non-human, some negligent, some deliberate, some oblivious, some aware. These actors, intermingling through assemblages, lurched into each other, turning into a sea of forces rushing and flowing together, pulverizing more than 20 square kilometers. While the assemblages were coming in and out of form, totally ignored by superior human order, the city was acted upon. Did we fall prey to inattentiveness? The desire of a chemist to see what ammonium can do as an oxidizing agent, or of a farmer to know how it can contribute to growth, enabled them to discern life in ammonium and thus to collaborate productively with it. Could desire and inattentiveness be opposites? If desire is productive, is inattentiveness destructive? The desire of letting ammonium nitrate linger en masse, waiting to be something else, is of another nature. It has an intrinsic capacity, potential, fate. What does it want? Billions of microscopic organisms were thriving at the entrance of the city in waiting. The choreographers, the human actors, are aware of the packed matter at the port of Beirut, ignorant of its liveliness. But awareness alone is not enough. One can be aware and careless, aware and ignorant, aware and inattentive. On that day, while the sun was setting at 6:08, the estimated 2,750 tons of ammonium nitrate collided with its environment, heat, pressure rapidly decayed the chemical, exploding violently, wiping out the city and its people. Political scientist Hannah Arendt describes a revealing representation of modern society in which human self-consciousness is dominated by economics. She describes the condition of individuality as being swamped in the collective life of the human species, committed to consumption and production, moving relentlessly on its way. There was a monster forming, and before revealing itself, the political fabric kept feeding it with their lack of energy, fueling it with life. Perhaps the lack of energy converted into massive energy is the formula to inattentiveness. Forensic architecture's investigation unfolds through visualization of the events minutes prior to the blast. They reveal and assert what the inhabitants saw but couldn't process or describe. It took 14 minutes. Right after that instance, a new assemblage forms when the loaded warehouse dust, the hazardous dust, collides with the slowly formed mundane dust of the city. It is now a different entity consisting of new characters with different meanings. Dust always settles, but before it does, it is the most powerful homogenizing agent. It conquered the territory, blinding, muting, numbing every living organism it encountered that day in Beirut. Suffocating life, penetrating the innermost pockets of living organisms. Then it settled in homes, streets, lungs, offices, nostrils, hair. How long is it going to stick around? I had never seen so much dust, such varied dust, a composite of glass, stone, dirt, blood, metal, human emotions. And we had to brush it away, clear people's lives away, speculating on what exactly each speckle of dust was. Encountering ripped pieces of a photograph with the face of a young woman who is no longer. The items on the floor that day and for days after the explosion were vibratory, at one moment disclosing themselves as live presence and at the next as inanimate matter. Jane Bennett in Vibrant Matter writes about the thing power, the curious ability of inanimate things to animate, to act, to produce effects, dramatic and subtle. From that day, the treatise existed beyond its alliance with human significance, nature, or activities. The original actor went from being a powerful, invisible, foreign, unmanageable concept to becoming the most mundane, inert, daily encountered form, dust. It is paradoxical that the most powerful of assemblages was invisible, but as soon as it is noticed in its switch of state, it becomes completely powerless. Thus, the most harmless of its states. No human agent interacted with it until it settled. Ammonium nitrate was ignored in its spring-loaded, most volatile capacity. Is it that we are unable to process things outside of our scope? The new assemblage, teeming with life in the empty lots of Beirut, no longer possesses any chemical intensity. Instead, it exudes a less empirical intensity. Our memory is embedded in the object, torn apart by the explosion. Those memories are still being swept in the invisible corners of the city, but there isn't really a place to sweep things away. Dust is but the smallest bit of memory. It contains something beyond itself, an archive of something that once was. Stripped of every bit of material memory, what does the destruction of one's environment mean? Hannah Arendt has argued the reality and reliability of the human world rests primarily on the fact that we are surrounded by things more permanent than the activity by which they were produced. But somehow, in the case of Beirut, we outlived the city. Will this dust not settle blissfully this time? This event is not a unique, isolated phenomenon, but rather a product of years of inattentiveness, a part of a system. Will it provoke a paradigm shift, or are we doomed to repeat these cycles of inattention? What is destructive is our oblivion, romanticizing that life goes on. They say ignorance is bliss. Jane Bennett advocates the vitality of matter because her hunch is that the image of dead or thoroughly instrumentalized matter feeds human hubris and our earth-destroying fantasies of conquest and consumption. It does so by preventing us from detecting a fuller range of non-human powers circulating around and within human bodies. These material powers, which can aid or destroy, enrich or disable, ennoble or degrade us, in any case, call for our attentiveness. Thank you.
Thank you, Shahar. The next two papers are coming from diploma thesis, and one of them is 61 pages long. So the challenge for our two presenters, our last two for today, is to somehow condense and to convey in 5 minutes the breadth of a long piece of writing. So I think we should take that into consideration as we turn over to Richard Aina, A Culture of Craft, West Africa, Un or UN Objectified. Over to you. Working with Mark Campbell and Manolis Chavakakis in thesis.
Thanks for the introduction, Mark. I'm just going to share screen now quickly. So in between the introduction and the conclusion, the thesis is split into like three separate chapters, which I'll sort of summate and then introduce the introduction conclusion on either side. So this thesis aims to progress towards a novel offering regarding a subject matter that has grown to become deceptively familiar. One can recognize objects of old as symbolic, embodying a mythological character. Bruno Latour mentions that the material world confronts us only to serve as a mirror for social relations. Any objects that are held in Europe in association with Africa supersede almost all other items of antiquity in the curiosity that they have historically attracted. In a typical museum, the culture of a continent is somehow encapsulated in plan, whilst the customary text for each item on display is somewhat informative. This exercise demands further in-depth interrogation, exploring how and why particular objects of African craft are initially created within a specific context and the various infrastructures that have existed and persist, allowing them to find themselves disassociated from their social religious premise. The Lobi peoples and ethnic group were identified as ideal sample size, and more detailed understanding of these parameters will proliferate original and thought-provoking propositions. So chapter one, the West African object, its premise. The Lobi are situated at the intersection of Southwest Burkina Faso, Northwest Ghana, and Northeast Cote d'Ivoire. They believe in a Garden of Eden-esque premise where God was initially content but decided to turn his back on his children after the fall. In his benevolence, he sent forth Thila, serving as intermediary entities to look over the people. This centralized belief system is manifested through their craft, the Bateba. Cared for by a single village diviner, who through divination would contact the Thila through the animist Bateba, conveying their prohibitions to the people, residing in the domestic shrine at the rear of the dwelling, operating as a spiritual vessel. Each Bateba is crafted with a specific purpose matched by a physical trait. Some pertain to current rudimentary matters, whilst Bateba of greater supernatural power would shape the future, helping women bear a child, whilst the extremely powerful can block forces of witchcraft. Essentially, it is through craft and production that tradition and cultural identities maintain as they oscillate through time. Chapter 2, the West African object, a historical tug of war. Labouré, the French colonial commander within Lobi country from 1914, referred to these Bateba as export models, crafted as sacred figures, became commissioned high-volume replica producers. These hybrid styles gradually made their way into French institutions for the demands of early intellectuals and anthropologists, birthing an ethnographic endeavor. From being initially flogged in ramshackle flea markets to becoming curiosities of Picasso and his peers in the early 1900s, thanks to ambitious dealers such as Guillaume and Raton, these newly coveted objects moved to the comforts of wealthy collectors' homes and the galleries of the world's major museums. In reaction to colonial warpings of their socio-religious structures, West African craftsmen produced these figures for Western tastes. Yet anthropologists and dealers rejected these replicas, supposedly tainted by recent events, unlike their purer predecessors. Throughout West Africa, Muslim traders operate as cultural brokers in local markets as middlemen, using their deep networks to extract crafted wood and sculpted mud exported for overseas relatives and familiar collectors. Sold from a local villager for pittance, these exported commodities increase exponentially in price the further they are from their point of origin. Chapter 3, the West African object, ownership through action. In economic terms, African art has historically existed as an internationally traded export from which logically the exporting nation should financially benefit from. Via intricate workings of Hausa traders in Abidjan, within Cote d'Ivoire, markets of Trècheville, Kokodi and Plateau quarters become the creative clusters with workshops and warehouses. Since around the turn of the millennium, furniture manufacturing firms in Arusha, Tanzania have been growing rapidly. In 2009, China became Africa's top lender, surpassing the World Bank, becoming its leading trading partner, improving the basic infrastructure of that is at present lacking through various factors. With a projected 500 million Africans migrating to cities by 2030, there will be a profound need for further development that will benefit from crafted furniture and construction and objects alike. Incentivized and supported regional and rural clusters of industry could thus help develop new vernacular typologies in healthy and competitive environments. Could old colonial tracts be used for the extraction materials, be reinvigorated for the intra-African trade of goods? So here's the conclusion. Potential for craft-based trade to be reimagined on a global scale as an instrument for diplomacy has the scope to highly encourage sustainable development whilst reinvigorating and reimagining existing systems that currently have unrealized potential. The trappings of globalism forced conformity and homogeneity, as we have witnessed by default, extant tribes within West Africa, like the Lobi, are increasingly faced with the decay of their traditions and culture. China successfully travailed a unique and uncharted path, although unlike the West and China, Africa has long been bloated by a plethora of raw materials that continue to be nonsensically mismanaged. Inter-African trade must be employed through a liberal approach, with wood and timber being a raw material for craft-based outputs alongside strategic afforestation initiatives. On a state level, concurrent top-down and bottom-up schemes must be employed, controlling the influence of traders, establishing a stronger dialogue between rural communities and local governors. Such initiatives require unified and focused reform within existing infrastructures throughout West African governments, thus improving the operating potential of such an industry. Patience and persistence must be employed over decades, with continued and consistent efforts to be employed with each successive party that holds power. This is the end. Thanks.
Thank you, Richard. Just have to say, I love thesis. On to our last presenter today, Yoshiya Zhu, presenting The Search for Unrealized Balance, The Convenience Store and a Critique of Everyday Life. Over to you.
Hi, thank you. So I prepared actually my presentation that I'll send the link now. And I hope it kind of embodies more of the paper in general, as well as some more of the observational footage that's not included in the paper itself.
Okay, so thank you. And so we find that in the chat.
I just sent it in the chat. Okay. Thank you.
The common image of the convenience store is dominated by the likes of retail franchises. Its genericness so overwhelming, it subverts into a strangely unique place in the collective imagination. The lived experience of everyday life resonates with us through its unspoken complexities and unrecognized certitude. Gentle gestures of everyday life conducted without forethought are often found in the daily places we pass through. Its significance lies in its agency to simultaneously reflect perceived banality and reveal the distant, present in the dualities of everyday life. The space is a coinciding intersection between core domesticity and the public realm. The nature of the convenience store glimpses into the paradox of the ordinary, a preservation of actuality behind the veil of actuality. As urban living becomes increasingly entrenched in the pursuit of growth, support systems at phenomenal scales has installed a capitalist-defined concept of convenience as the objective features of everyday life. In the narrative of ideological actuality, satisfaction is the attainment of ordinary things at exceptional means. Convenience in the home, however, is defined by the facilitation of balance rather than the pursuit of speed and simplicity. Home is where we readjust from the extremities of external forces. For decades, Western urban planners have used convenience as a design tool to promote better living in public spaces. It has become a blanket word to give the impression of greater freedoms when in fact there is a top-down control of a pre-planned lifestyle. Such perceptions of convenience, in the same manner as everyday life, is simply taken as is. The preservation of truth without questioning its validity may only reorganize modes of production, or yet reinforce existing organizational structure and perpetuate the archaic notion that moving beyond the boundary drawn by our daily routines into the other is bad. The ordinary is a realized perception, but it is continuously lived as if it is the actual. Moving beyond the self-drawn boundary reminds ourselves that the everyday life is self-evident. We seek the convenience store as a solution to small interruptions. Our pursuit for provisional accessibility to non-committal items indicates a need to constantly adjust impulse, maintenance, and deterioration within the shifts of our normal routine. This idea of balance is not a means to maintain two static forces. It is a need to constantly return to a stabilized state, or in other words, to top up. Topping up can be as practical as purchasing domestic goods and services, but it also includes the daily upkeeps that help us keep satisfied. Whether it's a daily morning routine, taking prescribed vitamins, revisiting intimacy in relationships, or taking time off once in a while for personal rest. In the long run, small acts of maintenance perpetuate our state of satisfactory balance and reduces the likelihood of requiring future unexpected arbitration. This notion of top-up balance is not exclusive to routine. If the home anchors the core, the routine is bound by repetition of activities and places, then the other exists outside this perimeter. Crossing this threshold into the other can broaden the sense of self and open up the potential for an alternative ordinary. Engaging with routine and the other tops up the overall concept of balance in the everyday life. As the social and oftentimes economical anchors of neighborhoods, to nurture of overworked salarymen. The convenience store is a living room in the landscape, connecting people through ordinary desires, even when our own homes become unbearable with the contraction of everyday life. The continued viability of the convenience store in times of crises and even emergence of the supermarket has underlined the dissolution of actuality in the domestic realm. What we envisage as everyday life, separate domains sitting on either side of a duality, is a manufactured semblance. Rather than ritualize the iterative duties of normalcy from within, our projections of home should be unpacked beyond its boundary. Fringing on the threshold of dualities, the convenience store exists in our periphery as the paradox of everyday life. It reveals an extended dimension hidden behind the invisible curtain of the ordinary, quietly providing us the significance of maintenance and balance and the merits of small interruption to the routine.
Good, okay. We'll open it to the panel for remarkably different projects, but I'm sure the panelists will find beautiful threads between, and off we go.
Thank you for the three presentations. I'll go back to front. I think Yixing's was beautifully filmed. It was a bit shaky, but I think that's the style you're going for. It was clear, very clear, too surprisingly clear for video essay. Usually quite get jumbled up because people take too much credit in image to do their talking for you. I was a little bit disappointed that the film reference was all English reference, mainly because the English examples are diluted. So it's like, maybe there's a quirkiness to it that the English convenience store is, you know, halfway between the definition of home and then halfway between the image of the home. And then whereas there, in my head, as it was, I was going through the film, there was a number of, unfortunately, Asian films, which because the exaggeration is much bigger, the image is even more, the transition is even more extreme and dramatic, which actually serves your argument. So that was the only issue I had, which was well done. But you know, you do what you can. But the two films you chose, I think they're good examples. I think it just in my head, your argument would be more articulated. So going back to Richards, I think Richards was quite impressive as well. Especially, I think it touches upon a number of questions, research questions and issues and topic in terms of copies, in terms of cultural identity, in terms of kind of the transatlantic association that the other non-thesis essay all touched upon. And then I think Richard is a good demonstration of what can be done in extensive research, right? Which is, I think, collectively what all the jurors was telling the previous essay, to like, there's no end to an essay. You continue on with the topic of your choice and then just build, and then the depths of it, which can be developed. So, and then going back to, I lost the name, I'm sorry. What was Ricardo's essay?
Theo is my name.
I'm so sorry.
You're good.
Yeah, so the like, I was really excited when I first read your essay because it was a topic that, you know, I think in my head always associated with sort of postmodernism sort of rhetoric in terms of the symbol, but then it gets brushed aside because then it's almost always deemed to be non-architectural. And I think you made that link quite well in your presentation and in the essay itself, if I may say so. And then and you know, commercial architecture gets talked about a lot, but with fairly monotonous argument. So I don't think that was something I really quite liked in your essay, which is, if I may say so, the neutrality of it. I think Ricardo would disapprove the word neutrality, but that's how I think the essay was especially appreciative for myself. So those are my comments.
Thank you, Susan. Other responses from the panel?
Yeah, I feel like there's a few different kind of cross-cutting entry points, and I'm trying to decide which one is the most fun. I mean, I think that there's, like, if we just take the, if we take Theo and the last presentation, Yishia's presentation, there are two different kinds of ideas about, well, I'd say both of them kind of dwell on familiar, but nonetheless very important themes in urban studies, right? And the nature of urban experience. So for Theo, I mean, this idea of kind of trying to deconstruct vibrancy. I mean, I think you could even be, and both of them have to do with mood, I think, right? And your approach to this problem of urban financialization and development through vibrancy is quite interesting. My recommendation would be on this point of mood that you could be more angry, more enraged, critically enraged by vibrancy on the one hand, or another kind of useful approach is over-identification, right? And I think both of these come out of a kind of situationist critique of the city, right? And I feel like there was a kind of Debordian critique kind of lurking behind what you were talking about, the society of the spectacle, but also importantly, recuperation, right? You were implying, it seemed, that there was a kind of authenticity, perhaps even a culture that was being constantly recuperated and in its recuperation destroyed or neutralized, right? And this is a familiar process. So I think on the one hand, you could, if you're, and ultimately this is up to you, but if your mandate is to deconstruct, to disassemble this mirage, I think you can take a harder line, right? And a more materialist approach where you really attack financialization. You might need other sources. I would recommend Loretta Lease on gentrification and even Anna Minton, specifically for London. But you could also imagine another version of this where you actually kind of lean into vibrancy, right? And you actually over-identify with it and draw out the insanity of it, right? And to that extent, you know, I thought a lot about formats in these essays where it was interesting where some of these essays, not just yours, I thought of Paul's actually and the previous group as kind of ripe for a really good video essay. And in your case, I almost think this could be like a trend report, right? Along the lines of like K-hole or Dis, two kind of groups of artists who have really pushed that idea of commercial over-identification in the last, let's say, 10 years. But yeah, I think recuperation is a kind of key concept for that, and deciding whether you're going to take a kind of sober mood or actually kind of, you know, take the kind of almost extremist intoxicating route of actually kind of leaning into vibrancy. And then with the convenience store, and I kind of link these two together, I think it's interesting because, yeah, there was an emphasis on mood and also on, and maybe that has to do with the kind of domestication, like linking the convenience store to a notion of home, a notion of routine, almost of kind of collective ownership over this space, which extends our notion of the domestic space. But there was a sense in which this is also a kind of naturalization of the convenience store as a kind of a constituent element of the very fabric of everyday life, right? And it struck me that the vast majority of the essay takes different approaches to unpacking that question of what exactly are we talking about when we talk about the convenience store. But actually no definition of what everyday life actually means, right? and perhaps that was a specific compartmentalization, like an effort not to get overwhelmed, right? But the whole category of everyday life is in and of itself like a potential thesis, right? Because this was a major question, not a given, but a question, especially in French theory of in the post-war period, right? Again, I mean, it's funny that, I mean, I'm not sure exactly why, but both of your essays kind of, for me, link back to a kind of canon of French theory about the nature of urban life in the post-war period, right? And everyday life for like Henri Lefebvre is something that cannot be taken as a given, but must be historicized, theorized, and ultimately, in order to do that, in order to take it apart, right? But see, and this is like an easy for a critic to do, right? To say like, oh, have you considered the history of, you know, X idea, which is in your paper? I think actually in this one, there's an opportunity to sidestep that, which is not to actually rely so heavily on a given idea of, or an assumption of what everyday life actually means. And in that sense, to use the word less, and actually allow the material you're looking at, the convenience store, its various typologies, its histories, its kind of permutations from place to place, to allow that material itself to provide you with a definition of what everyday life is, right? To almost not impose or enforce, but a type that actually instantiates or provides us with a almost like a guide to what everyday life contains. For example, I mean, I think the thing that made me start thinking about this was actually another thing just, you know, related to my own experience of everyday life. You know, I'm in Los Angeles, but I'm in an old suburb, which, you know, isn't really a suburb anymore, but nonetheless has some of the trappings of that. So we don't have corner stores. We don't have convenience stores. We have big box pharmacies, right? Like Boots. So, you know, in the US, CVS and Walgreens are these giant corporations. There's a CVS or a Rite Aid or a Walgreens in every neighborhood. Walgreens owns Boots, right? I mean, I'm sure you're familiar with Boots. But these are like CVS is one of the biggest grocers in the nation. It's just a pharmacy. It's an apothecary, right? But they're like this kind of weird mashup of a supermarket, a big box store, a pharmacy, and a corner store all in one, right? And yet, for most people, and within that space, you can kind of like go down every aisle and imagine like, you know, what kind of person is being produced by this experience, you know, by these particular products, by these body modifications, by these foods, by these, you know, corn syrup products. I think you can kind of track a changing definition of what everyday life actually is through those spaces, rather than either assuming that it's there a priori or needing to theorize it in any kind of substantive way in advance. Sorry, that's a bit of a long train of thought, but I think it's kind of interesting how both of these essays are kind of proposing ways of living, and I'd like to kind of bring that to the forefront.
Thank you for the insight, Tim. Anyone want to pick that up or bring other perspectives?
I can go. Thank you. Everyone for your presentations and papers and theses. I think it's a nice sort of conclusion to the eight we saw earlier. So I think for me, what I find interesting between three of them with Theo and sort of the investigation of the vibrant is left quite open-ended. I want to commend you, Theo. It's a really difficult topic. We all have read many things on it, and I think you do a really good job of making it digestible, which I definitely commend with sort of how you've taken in the word vibrant. What I find interesting, knowing some of your other written work focusing on pubs and other typologies around London, how it does sort of connect to the piece on the convenience shop. And it seems like maybe there should be a conversation between both authors and how you sort of maybe can share your notes. So Yuzhou, I think you should definitely have a chat with Theo because there's certain themes. I think what with both of you, what I see is you're not, and maybe this is what what Tim was kind of getting at, is I'm not sure you're taking a stand with sort of how we're supposed to understand either the convenience shop or the relationship between the everyday and the domestic. And I mean, that's completely fine. It's a sort of essay tactic to do that, to let people sort of form their own sort of opinions. I think, but in saying that, I also would look at in terms of the everyday and the ordinary, Tim mentioned the Ferber, there's also Perec, and this kind of notion of undermining, right, certain ordinary and everyday foundations, right, to actually make real change or political change. I think that's what Patrick Keeler sort of is implying at times. And I think, yeah, it would be nice to maybe in the next sort of, or continuation, I should say, of the topics that you're working on, that kind of begins to emerge in terms of what you're sort of arguing for or against within this topic. But they're both, I really enjoyed sort of the content of them. I think, Richard, on the other hand, I mean, it's a really amazing body of research. The drawings, I think, should be mentioned. They're really beautiful and a nice addition to the piece. But at the end, you do make a declaration. And it's nice to see like the different approaches to of writing. And you do make almost like a call, right, to politicians and policy for change. And I think you should do that and make that part of your continued research. I think that it was really nice to hear after such a long thesis to sort of land on that moment. And then traveling to Beirut, I was really struck with like the imagery and the writing of the piece. I felt like I was in Beirut at times, like searching for this pile up of dust. And you really conveyed that. And I think a really, I felt like I was in the space, and it started to make me think of a lot of different kinds of projects that deal with dust, artists that are working with them, working with dust, and sort of investigation. Maybe almost it'd be nice to see like a scientific side to the piece in relation to the more poetic kind of explanation of it. Because when I started thinking about what was in the dust, I imagined like a drawing or analysis, and it'd be interesting to see that more scientific approach maybe as you continue the research. But thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed them.
Hi. Yeah. I just had a question really leading on from Ryan's point there to Shaha. And I just want to say how much I enjoyed the essay. You've clearly looked at forensic architecture, but have you seen Ines Feisman's Dust and Data? That is really, really good. And she writes beautifully about dust. And I'm sure that you have a lot in common with your descriptions of dust and the way she treats it. But my kind of question is really, this molecular approach is really, really interesting. But you do quote Hannah Arendt quite a lot, obviously writing on the banality of evil in the particular context of the Eichmann trial. So I'm just wondering, can you expand on how you see culpability and what this, if you can expand a little bit more on this concept of inattentiveness and how you can you develop that argument a little bit for us?
I mean, culpability itself in terms of who is responsible.
Yes, if you're seeing it as something that's more generally the populace, and inattentiveness, or whether you steer away from the kind of pointing the finger in the kind of traditional sense of saying these factors are playing. You do kind of go there, but you steer away from that, and you concentrate on the molecular kind of the dust.
But at the same time, you do quote Hannah quite a lot.
I think because it is still important to recognize that one of the big main actors is the political class, because this matter existed on paper for so many years. And so I guess this is where I link it with Hannah Arendt, because these matters existed on paper, and this is where the political class started pointing fingers. So like you just avoid it and point fingers at others. It's in a similar way with the Eichmann trial, where it's like, my boss told me to do that. And here it's the same, because the matter exists on paper and so many people know about it for a very long time. So in that matter, I think I draw the parallel with culpability and the human actors.
Great, yeah, thank you. No, it's a great essay, really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Just following on that, I mean, I also thought it was quite interesting. But the reference points that were brought to kind of flesh out or extend the kind of theorization of them, Jane Bennett and Hannah Arendt, I mean, I thought they worked, but I wonder, it struck me that there were some other angles that might provide descriptive agency, if I can put it that way. For example, I would never describe this as a natural disaster, so to speak, but certainly an environmental one, which kind of plays up the role of dust or the culpability of dust, right? It seems like the corruption narrative might fit well into a kind of environmental justice narrative, right? Along the lines of, the Exxon Valdez is kind of an ancient reference point, but Bhopal or the Deepwater Horizon incident in the Gulf of Mexico, where the human industrial political capitalist kind of matrix is implicated, and their culpability is not evidenced in what they say, but in the environment itself, right? It's to be seen everywhere, kind of spread, atomized throughout the city, right? A kind of corruption that you literally can't get out of your clothes anymore. So you might look at environmental writing as much as new materialist theory for a way to kind of extend this critique.
Kathy, did you have a hand up?
Yes. So I loved all of these papers for different reasons, but one thing that I think connects them when I see them presented back to back is this idea of language and the way that you each use language. And Shaha, I was particularly taken by the quote I wrote down was dust as archive of something that once was. And I thought this was so beautiful. And it made me think back to like the 9/11, when there was like so much discussion in New York and the city about the dust and what was in it and how that affected people. But I also thought of artists who've used dust, which, you know, is an interesting, from Wafa Bilal, the Iraqi American artist, to Vic Muniz. And Yishya, I loved the way you used language. It's so beautiful, not only in your paper, but in the video. And I think you have such a beautiful way with language. With Theo and Richard, there was something that wasn't, I think I didn't hear it, but I love these two papers. For me, I kept thinking authenticity, right? Because whenever they say vibrant, like in New York, it means like, oh, it's Bushwick and artists live there and it's cheap and it's rough. And then once it becomes commercialized, developed, it's sort of not authentic anymore in terms of like in our city. So, and then with Richard, I was fascinated by yours and the whole idea of African cultural artifacts or craft. And I was curious again about this idea of authenticity. So like, if it's used in ritual in Africa, it seems like then it's considered more authentic. But isn't it the same people making these products of craft? So I wondered if you had an opinion about that, Richard, because I love the work. I love the investigation you did. And I was curious, you know, how you felt about that. And especially because it's like a Western, maybe, or historical or commercial reading onto what is not our culture once it gets exported.
Thank you for the comments and the question, Kathy. I mean, it's sort of a deep rabbit hole, because even today, the figures that are created purely for sort of aesthetic or commercial means that then convey tropes of symbolic, like, aesthetics. And this has been increasing, say, over the past 150 to 200 years. And so now the hybrid forms that look somewhat socio-religious, but then they're not made for socio-religious purposes. But then there are some items that were socio-religious that are made earlier that were used for ritualistic means, but then remain in sort of institutions and museums, no longer being used for what they're initially made for. And obviously now in most museums, you're not actually able to know the origin of any of these items, much like even the Craftsman and Anonymous. And it's all a bit of like a mix with knowing the origin, why they were made, where they were made, or even who made them. It's all quite vague.
Thank you. I think it would be interesting. I don't know if you have curatorial ambitions, but I think it could be super interesting for you to kind of curate a show with some of this stuff, and then maybe a hybrid where there's also like artists who kind of riff on this, like people like Sharif Bey, who make things that look like African authentic objects, but you know, they're actually made in, you know, Ohio or something, and it's part of an art practice. It could be like a really interesting show for like a gallery or, you know, a small space.
No, thank you for that. On that note, I wish if I had 10 minutes to present, I would have then introduced my design project, which is actually just trying to tackle this whole study. And it seems like it was a lot of research, but I literally just wrote what I was reading because I knew nothing about what I was studying. But yeah, maybe another time I can tell you about the project. Thanks.
Thank you.
May I just add a 2 cents? Well, I'm trying to share some things because we are in very weird pandemic days, but I'm doing it in the least wrong way. I'm funneling all those PDFs through Edward Buttons. So, you know, I'm abusing him as the filter of the dubious legality of my collection of PDFs. But all these, why? Because I'm just, and this is for Richard, I recently was researching Aldo Rossi, and then I stumbled on a book on Africa, a really, really beautiful book called Unknown Africa by Leo Frobenius, a very early ethnologist. And I discovered that was the book that actually Mies van der Rohe had in his table, together with Schinkel's book. And that was the book that he always used African architecture references to explain structural elementarity to, and that was the book that he saw, that he photographed for his lectures. No, and I just sent a PDF of the whole book to Ed Bottom, so if he thinks he's correct, he can share it. And I was also planning on the same vein to share a PDF. This is a piece of my own scholarly craft. It's a very decent scanning of Mining the Museum by the American artist. And now I'm blinking on his name. It's an extraordinary exhibition by Fred Wilson. Sorry. Thank you, Kathy.
It's okay.
That, of course, reverses the whole thing. And throwing a couple of 2 cents of old school art history with the late Roman art industry, of course, by Alois Riegel, that poses already the problem of even the artifacts. that we get from antiquity were already artifacts, basically industrial objects, profusely replicated. And I also send, and just I promise I close, also an homemade scan of Danny Sharp's translation of Hermann Muthesius' The English House, just to, you know, share my two things on the Dennis Sharp Prize. I hope in this lack of libraries, these crazy crafty PDFs can help to spread a little bit the conversation with, you know, old school sources, what we call scholarly. This is my own mix of piracy and scholarship.
No, thank you. Thank you very much. Very kind of you. I've gone through a lot of old school sources, so I'm happy to receive more.
It's a nice note to begin to move our panel to deliberations on. Wanted to thank everyone in the event today, everyone who participated presenting a paper this afternoon, and all of your colleagues who've stayed with us for the duration. So hats off to you. Congratulations. As I said at the outset, just to be here today is really the point. And we'll enjoy the next 4 hours of deliberations as a panel, but I'm wishing everyone else a very good afternoon and looking forward to more writing, more discourse, more AA culture. Thanks to all of our panelists today.
Thank you.
Over to you, Sylvie. You need to give us our marching orders.
Yes.
Okay. So I will kindly request, again, let me just echo, well done, congratulations. What a nice day. I've been reading and listening to essays all day since the morning, and it's just a joy. So really, bravo. Now, I gently encourage you to please leave the room so that we can do our deliberation. We obviously need to do this privately. The results will be announced at the end of the week, so in the next couple of days. But really, our extreme bravo, congratulations to all of you, and see you hopefully soon.